Hello, this is Joe Polish, president of Piranha Marketing and founder of the Genius Network interview series, and you're about to hear one of my Genius Network interviews, and I just want to thank you for taking the time to listen to this, and I hope you find it very useful. If you want to find out more information about some of the interviews and resources that can help you in your business, you can go to www.joepolish.com, and we have a Joe Polish Recommends section with all kinds of resources and vendors and services and products that we recommend that can help you in your business. And also for more useful interviews and a whole list of other people that I've interviewed, you can go to www.geniusnetwork.com. Thanks and enjoy the interview.
Hello, this is Joe Polish, Piranha Marketing and founder of the Genius Network. And I'm going to do an interview with a fascinating guy by the name of David Wolfe, who's in Ontario right now. Right, Dave?
Right, that's Ontario, Canada, not Ontario, California.
Okay, I'm glad you made that distinction, which is good. And that is where we actually met. I recently met David in person at an event that I was helping organize, engaged today with Richard Branson, who's a buddy of mine, speaking along with the Dalai Lama and a whole host of amazing people. And my good friend Gail Kingsbury brought me to you and said, you got to meet David. He's unbelievable. He's amazing. He knows so much about health and nutrition and raw food and all that sort of stuff. So you gave me some of your raw chocolate, and it was awesome. And we chatted for a little bit, and here we are getting ready to do a Genius Network conversation.
Well, fantastic, and thank you for having me in the interview. And I want to just send an appreciation and thank you and gratitude out to Gail Kingsbury. She is a superhero mom, an amazing organizer and administrator, and really a true love to work with.
I totally agree, and I think having said that, because she's a friend of mine, I think we should make fun of her too along the way. But Gail is super cool, and yeah. So let me go through who David Wolfe actually is for people that have not heard of you and have no idea, and then I'll hit you up with some really cool questions, because you're in the health, eco stuff, nutrition, and you're a natural beauty expert. So here is David's bio. You'd think he was a rock star with a fan base like his. America's top CEOs, global ambassadors, Hollywood celebrities, busy professionals, and even the most powerful buying influence in the nation, moms. But it's not rock and roll that they flock to him for. It's his nutrition mission and the natural health and beauty eco revolution that David Wolfe champions. With a master's degree in nutrition and a background in science and mechanical engineering, David Wolfe is considered one of the world's top authorities on natural health, beauty, nutrition, herbalism, longevity, chocolate, and organic superfoods. Leading the field with his vision, mission, education, and business, David has over 15 years of dedicated experience and understanding of the inner workings of the delicate chemistry and hardcore mechanics of the human body and how the body is affected by the modern-day stressors of today's fast-paced, overworked, and unbalanced lifestyle, which is literally a killer to our beauty, health, and longevity. A highly sought-after health and personal success speaker, David has given over 1,700 live lecture events in the past 15 years. And today, David Wolfe continues to share the stage with a boatload of famous people in the personal development industry, people like Tony Robbins, Mark Victor Hansen, Jack Canfield, Buzz Aldrin, T. Harv Eker, John Gray, Les Brown, Barbara DeAngelis, Brian Tracy, and many more, of which most of those people are my friends. And so you got a website, which is David Wolfe, spelled W-O-L-F-E.com, and you're also the co-founder of thebestdayever.com, an online health magazine, and president of the Fruit Tree Planting Foundation, which is ftpf.org. So check out those sites. David, what else do you do, man? You're doing a lot of stuff. You've written a lot of books. I'm actually going through your fantastic book called Superfoods right now, and so it's a perfect time for us to do this interview. What else are you doing that I didn't mention?
Well, I'm really into farming and gardening, strangely enough. You know, when I get a chance to be home, I spend my time out in the garden. I spend my time growing orchards, and I have a lot of friends in that field, so I've been educated on how to grow the best food ever. So I love doing that. It's a favorite hobby.
Awesome, awesome. Well, you know, I'd like to kind of just let me preface this with saying that you are a person that has, before this interview started, I was asking you how long have you eaten raw food, and you said 16 years, right?
16 years, yeah.
So you've eaten no cooked food in 16 years.
That's right.
So I know a lot of people are going to be like, what the hell is going on here? But other people that are obviously in the quote-unquote raw food field, industry, whatever you would call it, club, totally kind of get that. You made a comment on a video that really struck me. One video, I think it was you speaking at one of Harv's events, and it, you were saying, is it possible to never feel bad ever, to never feel sadness or depression, to remove these emotions from our psyche totally? That was, and I transcribed it exactly the way you had said it. And I thought, huh, is that because of the way you eat, or is it because of other stuff? And I'm a guy that currently eats a pretty clean diet compared to the standard American diet with, I guess, the acronym SAD that I heard someone say. Standard American diet equals SAD. However, you know, I don't eat completely raw, of course, and I'm not a vegan or vegetarian. I've thought about going in those directions at times because I really do feel great when I, you know, have less meat in the diet. And I also believe we live in a world and a society where because of factory farming and meat production and everything, it's not only completely inhumane, but the food is just poisonous because of all the chemicals and the hormones and the steroids and the, you know, the corn that they feed animals that really aren't intended to eat corn and the genetically modified food. So there's a whole variety of stuff that lead to this. But, you know, there's so many places of where to start. I'll first ask you about those emotions. I mean, to never feel sadness or depression, to remove those emotions from our psyche totally, is what do you mean by that?
Well, I guess I want to begin on how I got into success technology and prosperity consciousness and super learning, which happened at a summer camp that I went to in 1984. And that's actually where I first met Tony Robbins. And I spent 9 or 10 days up there learning accelerated learning skills, how to get into a prosperity state of consciousness, what success is all about, and whole different ideas that I'd never been exposed to before. Now, I bought those ideas. I mean, I became a student of success technology from Napoleon Hill to, you know, the stuff that's being put out now by Jack Canfield, the stuff that you put out on marketing and, you know, propelling yourself into financial success as well as emotional, spiritual, physical, mental wellness and health and success. And so one of the things that came up for me at a very young age is that I was always a very vigorously alive person. I never wanted to be stuck in a 9-to-5 job because I just couldn't sit in one place for that long. And I always wanted to see if I could drive out of my psyche, out of my body, out of my mental state, this idea of being depressed or sad or lonely. And so I spent a lot of time practicing positive thinking. You know, I guess I was inspired by Earl Nightingale originally. I think in one of his tapes or his recordings, he mentions, you know, if you have a negative thought, you have to start over and do 30 days of no negative thoughts. I actually did that stuff. And one of the things that I found with nutrition, especially when I started into it as a hobby at 18 years old due to allergies to dairy products, that's how I got involved in nutrition. Before that, I ate everything just like everybody else does. And then step by step, I started realizing I was allergic to dairy products and eggs, and then I was allergic to wheat, and I got off that stuff, and that caused me to begin to research and learn. What I found out through dietary research and being a gastronaut, because I am a gastric explorer, what is the fringes of where we can go with our diet, as a gastronaut I found that it's easier to hold on to high energy emotions and states of consciousness if you eat well. And what I mean by that is you eat in such a way where you never have a stomach ache, you never have a headache, you never have any side effects from what you're eating, for example, being extremely tired or just being totally wiped out energetically or whatever. So the key idea here is that I learned that it's easier to stay in a high energy state of emotion, of physicality, and of essentially really spirituality when we eat better. And because I'm at the extreme of, you know, what we can eat and what's the best food ever, I find it actually impossible for me now when I take this nutrition protocol to heart and all my practice with success technology, it's pretty much impossible for me to get into a state of depression, sadness. I don't experience those emotions. That's not in my reality. And that's what I'm inviting everybody else to realize is possible, because that's something that I created for myself. Really, it's a big accomplishment, but it doesn't really mean anything in the business world. It doesn't really mean anything in the book world, but it certainly does mean something to each individual in their own world.
So what you're saying is you've not, like, broken down and just cried recently because you got frustrated that someone took your parking space or something like that?
Yeah, I would say that. I mean, the worst emotion that I emote in my life is probably anger, which is usually as a result of someone not living up to my expectations of them, which is really all my fault. But beyond that, the sadness, the depression is all gone. And I told a friend of mine this, who's a famous author, my friend Daniel Pinchbeck, and he said, so what do you mean? Like, you don't have any sad music on your computer? And he hit it right on the head, actually. I took all the sad songs off my computer and deleted them, so I don't have any of that music anymore, nothing to remind me about that side of living, right? I want to be on the high side of life.
Interesting. Well, that's cool. Well, and, you know, and I wanted to kind of start with that because obviously I know that there's more to this. Anyone that I've ever met that has achieved any level of success or mastery in any area of life, it doesn't just come to them because they're doing one thing. If you watch people, there's usually a variety of stuff. If they're eating well, they're also exercising, they also have developed some sort of personal development program in many areas, be it financial or spiritual or being a better parent or, you know, being a nicer person, whatever. So there's a variety of stuff, but the byproduct, you know, the whole saying, you are what you eat, do you believe that to be true? You are what you eat.
That's the best thing I've been able to come up with in 20 years of research in the field of nutrition, you know, now going on 21 years. This idea of you are what you eat is very profound. It's very deep. And I've explored it really to the nth degree with everything that we have available before us. And as we evolve this conversation between the two of us, Joe, you know, you'll see that the depth of my understanding, but not just understanding, but my participation in herbalism, from Amazonian shamanism and Amazonian herbalism to Central American herbalism to North American Native American herbalism to Chinese medicine to Ayurvedic medicine, it is full on. I mean, I've taken this stuff and I've actually eaten these things, and from that experience, you know, I think I got a lot to say about these systems of medicine that are out there and the potential of what this is all about. It's really deep and it's really amazing. You are what you eat is something that I believe we've just had the technology, maybe in the last 15 years, to really explore it to the nth degree by, for example, comparing these herbal systems, the 150 years of raw food nutrition information that's been present in American literature and experience, the superfood revolution and putting that into the mix, and then putting that all together and going, what the heck does this mean, and what is it doing for us? When you get onto that level of exploration of you are what you eat, it's profound what is sitting in front of us.
Yeah, and I've been doing a lot. I've spent a good portion of my life studying nutrition, learning about exercise. You know, I try to think I'm not completely hardcore. I never did athletics in school because I was actually a skinny, shy kid. I never really did sports, and I had a bad experience when I was in Little League with a coach that was kind of a medieval guy. And it totally ruined my whole liking of sports growing up because of one bad experience with a really bad individual. And so, it wasn't until my adult life when I just started looking around at how unhealthy people became as they got older. And I was like, I'm not going to live that way. So I went through my crazy partying years in high school consuming more bad drugs and toxic things than a person ever should. And it wasn't until my adult life that I really, you know, kind of got my act together in exercise and nutrition and stuff, but I'm always studying. And you know, recently with movies like Food Inc., which I think is fantastic, and, you know, King Corn, C-O-R-N, you know, there's movies like that that just really expose what's going on in the food industries. And I think a lot of giant food companies are just flat out evil corporations. I mean, they are poisoning people under the guise of calling it food. And I've recently been studying a lot of stuff related to raw foods. And so for my own purposes, a lot of the questions and things I'd love to have you talk about today are for my own interest. And I'm going to ask you things that I think a lot of my listeners, I've got thousands of people that listen to Genius Network, would be curious to know, because most of them aren't raw food eaters and really wouldn't even know where to start. So why do you eat the way you do? And then I'll ask you about everything from juicing to supplements to proteins to sweets to all kinds of stuff. But why have you chosen raw food, as if there is a simple answer to that?
I guess it began when I was a very wild child, probably like yourself. And I always wanted to be on the high side of life, whether that was by drinking or taking drugs or whatever when I was a teenager. as that matured, I finally became aware of the information that suddenly landed in front of me that essentially said, this is what this information said to me. It said, the man's fall from grace has a lot to do with cookery. And if we were to get rid of cookery, we could regain our natural high angelic state. Now, my generation, which is your generation, is a generation that's really into seeing if this stuff is for real and, like, trying it out. I think past generations are more of the state of, like, well, here, you should try this, but we don't do this, but, you know, it might be good if you try it. Just check it out, right? It was more like that. But our generation was more of the generation, like, look, if this is going to turn me back into what I'm naturally supposed to be, sure, I'll give it a try. What the hell? So I literally started eating raw foods without knowing a darn thing about anything. At that time already, I had gotten into shopping at organic food stores because of the allergies that I had realized I had when I was about 18. It took me about 5 years to really get to the place where suddenly, maybe I was 23, and I suddenly was looking at this going, raw food, that makes sense. That's pretty much what I eat anyway. And I just went totally whole hog plus the postage into it and began to explore what this is all about. And one of the things that happened within the first year is that I did feel experiences in my biology that were profound, profound spiritual experiences. Now, I'm not an airy-fairy, hippie, spiritual kind of a person. I think a lot of that is really far out there and, you know, not where I'm coming from. But I had experiences that were so profound to me personally that it inspired me to keep going and to keep going. And I guess I'm at a point now where I realize, because I've seen the difference between, you know, the way I did things before, which is, you know, the anything goes kind of diet. I've done vegetarian diets or limited food diets where, you know, you calorie restrict or cut out certain things, and then eventually got into raw food. Having all of that perspective, when I look back, I'm so stoked that I made the choices that I did and banked on what's natural first. Right? Because a lot of these supplements and stuff and bodybuilding stuff, it's all artificial. We don't know what the heck it is. So I had this very fundamental idea from the very beginning that I'll try what's natural first and let me see what happens. Of course, that led me to, you know, extreme natural, which is raw food. And in step by step by step, I began to be educated by the masters in the field of raw food nutrition who had been doing it 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, and they taught me. And I'm just standing on their shoulders, and what I'm doing is bringing forth this knowledge of what has been learned at the fringes of nutrition back to where we are in our everyday lives, and is there something that we can benefit from these people like myself who've explored the fringes? And the answer is yes, you bet. There's a ton of stuff we can all benefit from, because all you have to do is be able to blend a smoothie in the morning or eat, you know, this snack food or this trail mix instead of the other, and you're 90% there.
Okay, well, you know, what about, you have a video on your site, I think it's on the best day ever, which is about the Bionic Burger.
Yes.
And I think that is just hysterical. I mean, I always loved the movie Super Size Me. I thought it was fantastic about Morgan Spurlock, who ate at McDonald's for 30 days straight. And if people have not seen that movie, they absolutely got to go see it because it's great. But explain the Bionic Burger a little bit. This will give people some perspective, and then we'll come back to raw food, obviously. But I want to paint a picture here. And give a perspective of just so people are aware of what some of the foods are doing and how they decompose.
Well, the story begins with Len Foley, who's a business partner of mine, and by the way, a huge supporter of mine. Even back 8 years ago, when it didn't seem like there was much of a market for raw food, he stood behind me and believed in that we could create businesses together, and we have been very, very successful together over the years. And he had a friend who went to a McDonald's one day and bought two hamburgers, stuck one in his trench coat pocket, ate the other one, and then a year later was getting his coat out again, and he realized that the hamburger was still there. And it had hardened and actually become kind of fossilized and never decayed. And then he began to realize, wait a second, there's so many preservatives on this stuff that maybe it doesn't even decay at all. So he began a burger museum by going around and buying different burgers back in the 90s and then putting them in glass cases and then showing them to people like, hey, this burger hasn't decayed since 1994. And that inspired the creation of the video, The Bionic Burger, which is his story, essentially. You know, that these burgers are so toxic, they're so filled with chemicals that they can't even be naturally degraded by bacteria and fungus and spores and things that are in our environment that normally return things back to the earth.
And I mean, how much of the American diet, as an example, would you say consists of that type of food?
Oh, it's vast. It's shocking. It's like 85%. It's a shocking number. I mean, in all the work that I've been doing all these years in creating awareness about the toxicity of the food supply, the hormones, the pesticides, the larvicides, the fungicides, the herbicides, the suicides, the genetically modified ingredients, the calcium carbonate shock that's being added back to milk, the contamination in tap water that's used to, you know, knead bread in order to, you know, get the bread to go into a doughy consistency. You know, that water isn't exactly pure water, but it works its way into our food supply in the bread and other products that are made with contaminated water. And it just goes on ad infinitum to the point, Joe, where what happens is people go, oh, my God. They become conscious of it, and they go, what in the hell do I do? And then that would lead, like in your case, it leads you to suddenly go, what the hell is this raw food stuff about? I mean, you know, how do I clean myself up now? Because I acted in a way that I thought was right, but later found out there was all these chemicals. Now what do I do? And that's where I fit in. Is like, where do we start? What do we do once we become conscious and aware of the poor quality of our food supply? You know, where do we go for quality?
And I would love to have you lay out some strategies for that. And certainly, I'm going to recommend that people, if this resonates with, you know, them and what we're talking about. Certainly, there's only so much we'll be able to cover in a period of time here, but I want to give people a fantastic overview and a good understanding of things that they can really walk away from listening to us and make some positive impact on their life. Even if they just transition into more of eating healthier foods, it's gonna be fantastic. So the goal here is not to try to convert anyone into anything. It's more just to provide information and you sit and listen to it and see if it makes sense to you, and then you could make those choices. And, David, you're the best person that I would know to go to and ask how to guide people in this particular area. I will say that I have tremendous amounts of reactions to food. When I eat dairy, when I eat wheat or anything with gluten in it, you know, when I eat certain, you know, lots of different foods, I get immediately my sinuses get stuffed up. So my body is reacting to certain foods, and so I don't eat dairy. I very much, you know, limit wheat. And I don't know if this is even accurate or you would know, but I had a natural pathic doctor tell me that the reason there's so many reactions to gluten, because, you know, where's all this gluten allergy stuff coming from? I didn't remember it 10 years ago, and all of a sudden it's now in grocery stores and stuff. And she said, well, you know, because of the genetic engineering of wheat, 50 years ago wheat had 3% gluten in it. Now it's like 50%. I don't know if that's accurate, but do you know if that's the case?
Well, it is. That's somewhat accurate. I mean, 50% is pretty much impossible, but
okay.
It's probably something like from 3% to 7% or something like that. And but that is a significant change. Now, gluten is a form of protein that's in wheat, and wheat generally is about 12 to 14% protein. You know, this is so, I love researching the ancient world and how we got onto eating grass seeds, which is what wheat is, or wheatgrass is. And, you know, the reason why Napoleon invaded Egypt was to get access to the high-protein grain, the 16% protein grain. Anyway, this protein, the gluten that's present in wheat, is when it's cooked, it can cause reactions or allergies in lots of different folks. It's one of the most allergenic foods out there. When it's eaten raw, that's a totally different phenomenon, by the way. And there are lots of foods out there that people could eat raw, for example, chocolate, that they are not allergic to, but if they eat it in a cooked form, they are allergic to it.
Interesting. Okay, so why does some people's bodies, say like yourselves or like mine, react to certain foods and others don't? Do you have any explanation for that?
Well, we're seeing more and more of this as time goes on. If somebody was to do a Google search on umbilical cord pesticides, just Google those words right there, umbilical cord pesticides, that what you would get on that is so darn shocking, it's crazy. And that is, I was told by my mom, and by the way, both my mom and dad are medical doctors. I was actually conceived in a medical school library. Actually.
Really? Yeah. What section? Like under what books were on the shelves? Do you have any idea?
Stranger than fiction. I don't know. So anyway, you know, if you were to go back and you were to look at you know, this whole area of allergies, you start to see that we're accumulating every generation the toxins of our civilization, which are numbered into the 75,000 right now in terms of artificial solvents, artificial glues, formaldehyde, pesticides, all this kind of stuff. And it's not being, my mom told me that that the placenta and the umbilical cord naturally filters it away from the baby so the baby's kept safe. That is not true. That is an assumption that we had in medicine for some time that turns out to be a false assumption. Therefore, we're seeing children being born with compromised livers. They've already been dealing with a toxic load from the embryonic stage, and they're born and they immediately have peanut allergies, nut allergies, soy allergies, corn allergies, mold allergies, mushroom allergies, all kinds of stuff like this, because their liver has already been overloaded and it's just going, wait a second, hold on, I'm just trying to deal with what we've got over here. And this, again, is something that's getting worse over time generationally.
Wow, and it's getting worse because basically we live in a world where food is becoming less of food, although they still call it that. Is that why?
Right, exactly. I mean, the food today is, it's hard to say that it's food with all, you know, with the massive amounts of processing. And again, what I really represent is kind of the polar opposite of the junk food industry, which is, you know, what is going on in the raw food industry and the superfood industry and the super herb industry, and what's really happening with living spring water as compared to, say, water filtration devices, and what are these things teaching us? So, you know, when people look at me, they go, okay, that's an extreme position, but when you hear what I have to say, you can kind of go, okay, actually, I could do that, and I could do that, because that's really what we're taking away from all this. It's not like some crazy diet. Forget that. What we really want to do is be able to go, okay, I can add this in, I can add that in, I can add that in, and that is the key word, add.
Gotcha. Well, you know, I heard Matt Monarch speak, and he talked about, he made this comment, which I think originally came from an interview he did with Dr. Fred Beeshe. Is that how you pronounce his name?
Yeah, Dr. Fred Beeshe.
Yeah, he's a guy that's been, you know, eating raw for like 40-plus years. And the comment was, it's more important what you don't eat than what you do eat.
Yeah, I think that's a valuable statement. That's
okay.
A valuable statement. Again, bringing it back to what's useful for us day to day, one of the things we can do to immediately avoid a whole bunch of toxic stuff is to start shopping organic. Go to organic health food stores. Start demanding organic food at your store. It's amazing what you can do with just asking. Just asking your local produce department what they can do for you and what they can get for you, because organic food is on a massive upswing right now. And, of course, we want to keep that, you know, that going, you know, at full speed, because we should be eating entirely organic food, but we want to make it easier for everybody to do that. And the more demand we create, the more supply is generated.
You know, me being in the, obviously, the marketing business, and, of course, anyone that really knows me knows that what I teach and preach is totally about value creation and doing ethical marketing. And, you know, obviously, money earned ethically is a byproduct of value creation. And there's a lot of people that, you know, utilize marketing in ways to package and position and sell crap, but give the impression that it's, quote-unquote, healthy. Is there a difference between organic food you would buy in a farmer's market versus organic food that you might see in, say, Costco or in a Walmart or something?
I'd say yes, there is a qualitative difference. Generally, farmer's market food is fresher, it's purer, it's grown in a less mass production scale. For example, anything that's showing up in Whole Foods is coming from mega farming interests where there's, you know, hundreds of acres of farmed corn, cabbage, lettuce, spinach, et cetera, whereas the farmer's market environment just gets a little bit more of that personal care from the farmer, right? They're a little bit closer to the food. They're growing those heirloom tomatoes, which are generally a slightly higher quality. So I always recommend farmer's markets as a place to shop. I always recommend getting to know your farmer and becoming friends with your organic farmers, because as an organic farmer myself, having two certified organic farms, it is not easy. It is a tough thing to do. And I do it as a hobby, so I don't do it full time. But, man, it's hard to grow organic food and to produce enough for you, your family, and your friends.
Yeah, I can imagine. Well, so, and there's some people, like in areas of California, where there's lots of availability of organic foods in other parts of the country, and then there's some places where people, I mean, their availability is so limited. So what does one do in situations like that?
Well, we have online shopping, which is totally amazing now. And this is one of the areas that I really fit in, was creating an entire market online for superfood distribution. So let's say you can't get organic lettuce in your local store. It's December. You know, what are you going to do? Well, fortunately, we've got other options. We can go to superfoods like spirulina. We can get our chlorophyll from that. or chlorella or marine phytoplankton or blue-green algae or a whole bunch of cornucopia of different superfoods that are out there that can nourish us with real high-grade, high-quality nutrients that we can order online, have delivered to our house. In fact, I just had a box just delivered right here today without having to shop at all. Beyond that, we can always ask our local stores, even if they're not organic, to get organic produce for us. And they're surprisingly willing to work with you. I mean, I've just found this over the years that they love it. I mean, I'm even getting hotels where we're doing our conferences to now to begin to bring in organic food into their restaurants, which is just, you know, it's an awesome development.
Great. Well, so you travel. How many days a year do you travel?
Probably 250.
Okay, so, and the reason I ask that is I want, because immediately, when it comes to eating well, there's going to be a lot of objections. Well, I can't do this, I work this way, I'm a parent, I'm a this, I'm a that, I'm a whatever. It's the same things that I've heard many people talk about as it relates to, why they can't exercise. And, you know, there's, if you don't take time out, I've always said this about exercise, if you don't take time out for it now, you're going to take time out for it later with, you know, the way your body's going to turn out with poor health. And I think the same thing can be applied to how you eat. And you have managed to develop rituals and habits that have allowed you to adopt very healthy ways of living, not just eating, but ways of living. And since the main focus here is really what you put into your body. Can you talk about that a little bit? I mean, how do you maintain all of this with all that travel, being on airplanes and being in situations where you're not going to – I mean, you obviously must travel with your own food.
Right. A lot of times I do. So that's the first lesson in the habits that I have. One of them is I'm more prepared like a squirrel for the winters, right? I've put stuff – I have a – you know, it's interesting, you know, coming from a doctor's family – my dad always carried a doctor's bag with him. Well, I carry it. Here's why I'm looking at my doctor's bag right now. But in it are all my superfoods, all my supplements, all my medicinal mushrooms. So I have all my herbs in here. And this is what I travel with. So whenever I get anywhere, I have it right there. And let's say I need something for calories. Well, I have a whole jar of different nuts and seeds, almonds, for example, goji berries. I have raw chocolate nuts, which are called cacao beans, in there. I've got vanilla beans in there to give it a really wonderful smell. I travel sometimes with different, like, little chocolates that we make at home. So those are sometimes broken up and crumbled up and thrown into a trail mix. I've got my own honey. You know, we're running a little bit of a hive operation here, so we have bees. So we have our own honey. So I've got that with me. So I'm prepared. That's number one. Number two, with Google and with our ability to access internet information, we can find out where the local health food stores are immediately, and not only that, almost always have GPS coordinates on how to get there from the airport, from wherever we're going to be doing a conference, let's say it's a hotel or say it's a somebody's studio or something like that. So it's become easier and easier and easier to get to where the food is, which is a very important development in my opinion. And then third, I'm psychologically predispositioned to, you know, go without, right? I've done lots of experimenting with fasting, with eating less, with water fasting, dry fasting, juice fasting. So what that's done is it's built up a certain level of willpower or a certain level of being able to resist temptation. This takes years to build up, but you certainly can build it up. And so therefore, if somebody says, hey, we're going to go out to a dinner, you know, where I'm at a conference or something, and they said, you know, we want to take out to dinner, I get to the dinner, and I'm not tempted by the food because I'm satiated, so I'll just drink water, or sometimes I will have brought a little bag, like a little lunch bag, with an avocado in it, maybe some sunflower seeds, maybe some olive oil, and then I'll, you know, order some vegetables and then put that all on there. And what ends up happening, by the way, when I do that is everybody at the table eats that. They're like, we want what you're having, and they basically just grab it from me, which is fine. I'm very happy to share. But I end up making food for people at restaurants quite a bit. It's kind of fun.
That is hysterical. Why do you have this nickname, Avocado?
When we first got started, this has to do with marketing, actually, so this is right up your alley. When we first got started, it was three of us. It was myself. My cousin came up with my name. It was Fats Avocado, kind of like Fats Domino, but, you know,
that's
appropriately
funny.
Raw food oriented. And then I had another business partner and a old friend of mine. His name was Captain Wheatgrass. And then my cousin, he was the Raw Courage Vegetable Man. And what the idea was is that the three of us would go out into the media as like raw food superheroes, you know, with, you know, throwing, you know, carrots at people and you know, dumping wheatgrass juice on people's heads and create like a big marketing fervor around it. Well, that never kind of materialized because those guys kind of dropped out of the scene. They weren't really public kind of guys. They don't like being up in the public eye. And the first part of my name, Fats, Fats Avocado, that Fats part dropped off and it just became Avocado and everybody just would call me Avocado. So it stuck.
Well, there you go. How many avocados do you think you eat in a given day?
Well, I'm up in the far north right now, so we're in central Ontario, Canada right now, so there's no avocados up here, so it's a zero for today. But if I was in Southern California or Arizona where you got the good stuff, or Hawaii, I'd probably eat one or two a day.
One or two, okay. Well, you know, a lot of the questions that I'm asking you are really kind of where to start, but I don't know if there is an easy answer of where to start. Your recent book is Superfoods. Maybe you could run through what is a superfood, why did you write a book about it, and what are some of them, and where do people get them?
Okay, well, let's reference back to what I was saying earlier, that at the fringe of what these gastronomic explorers like myself have come back with is this idea of superfoods. Now, what is a superfood? A superfood is a gift of great civilization, an identified agricultural product of top-notch quality and nutritive effects that was literally discovered by an entire civilization, propelled into its front position in front of that civilization, is still with us. For example, let me make that more clear. The Egyptians gave us the pyramids. They also gave us aloe vera. Aloe vera is one of the most extraordinary superfoods in this world. I mean, it's an amazing rejuvenator of skin cells, both inside our body and outside. It's an amazing detoxifier. It flushes our bowels out. And it just gives you a sense of well-being once you adapt to it, you know, once it's done its detox job on you, that very few foods could give you. Another one is the goji berry. Here's a system that comes out of China with 5,000 years of history, 8,000 food herbs, and they rank this particular berry up as number one. Well, immediately for me, with my perspective, I'm like, I better check that out. I mean, that's got the number one ranking. Let's see what this is about. Well, what you find out, it's a complete protein source. You find out it's one of the highest antioxidant foods in the world. You discover that it's the only food known to help us secrete human growth hormone. No other food has ever been shown to do that, but goji berry does. It is one of the most powerful invigorators for our eyesight because it's the best natural source of zeaxanthin, which is a beta-carotene type of molecule. These superfoods in general have many different tricks under their sleeves, not just one or two, like lettuce and broccoli, which are great. They've got great fiber. They've got great calcium, but, you know, that's about the end of it. When you're dealing with superfoods, you're dealing with things that really can switch on the big switches. Here's another one that I'm really into is maca, which preloads our hormone system or our endocrine system, our glandular system, with substances that can be converted over into growth factors and converted into hormones. And this is one of these things that's really important for creating vigor and vitality late in life, because as we go later into life, the major hormones like testosterone, progesterone, DHEA, insulin-like growth factor 1 and 2, these things decrease, and this has been correlated very strongly with the symptoms of aging. If we eat a food like maca, M-A-C-A, and it's like a creamer, it's a powder, it's a root that comes from the Andes Mountains, then we can stave off those types of age-related symptoms of feeling run down, not having enough energy, thinning skin, thinning hair, et cetera, which are created by, again, these low hormone levels. And then we can go on to raw chocolate, which is one of the great superfoods of the world. All chocolate is made out of a nut. That nut is the size and shape of an almond, except it has so many antioxidants in it, it's actually purplish-brown instead of being white like an almond. It's the highest antioxidant food in the world, this food that we make chocolate out of. We've heard it as cocoa, C-O-C-O-A, but it's really the word is cacao, C-A-C-A-O. Now, I began to do a lot of scientific research into cacao about 10 years ago and unearthed a lot of stuff. Now, where we are with it, just as a quick rundown, it appears that chocolate, and especially its raw form, cacao, is the number one food for cardiovascular health in the world, period. End of story. There's nothing even close according to the scientific literature. So if you eat enough chocolate, you will not have a heart attack. That has pretty much been conclusively shown. And in fact, if you look at the longest lived people in the world, like Jean Calment, C-A-L-M-E-N-T, you can Google her or Wikipedia her, you'll find out that in her diet she had 2.5 pounds of dark chocolate every single week. for her whole life.
How old has she passed away, or is she still alive?
She passed away at 122 years old.
And was she completely raw?
No, she wasn't completely raw, but she basically ate a diet of olive oil and chocolate.
Interesting. How do you spell her name again?
It's Calment, C-A-L-M-E-N-T. She was a French woman. Her first name is Jean, which is J-E-A-N-N-E.
Interesting. I love hearing stuff like this.
It's amazing, the research, because I'm of course, you know, like, on one end, I like to present information in a fun and entertaining and educational way, but on the other end, I'm very much a scientist. I love doing a lot of research on what I'm talking about. It's a deep passion. It's led to the creation of my books, like the Superfoods book, but it also has led to changes in my own diet.
Not to derail you, because I want you to keep going down this list, because it's great here. Like, so when you say raw chocolate, you're advocating real raw chocolate, not processed, because what a lot of people do is they'll hear things and say, oh, I can eat Hershey bars, I can eat Cadbury eggs. It's not what you're saying. And, you know, like white chocolate. What the heck is white chocolate?
White chocolate is basically chocolate made without cacao solids or cacao powder or cacao beans. It's just using the cocoa butter or the cacao fat or the oil from the cacao bean, which generally is of a whitish, yellowish consistency, and that's what gives white chocolate its particular color.
Gotcha. Okay, so continue. I don't want to derail what you're saying because you're just rapid-firing some great stuff here.
Okay, cool. So when we get into these areas like chocolate, just to bridge that area of like, okay, somebody hears, okay, I should eat chocolate, but what kind? Of course, there's gradations of quality. So I want to mention that you want to move away from the Hershey's and the Mars bars over to, and the Kit Kat over to, let's say, dark organic chocolate, eventually over to raw organic chocolate products, which are now available in almost every health food store in the Western world, which is an amazing development over just the last 5 years. And then if you really are into it, you can get your own cacao beans at home and play with making your own chocolate drinks, your own chocolate concoctions with the real substance itself. Now, more on cacao, because chocolate is the drug of choice for our world for a reason. And the reason is because it is so darn rich in the minerals that help us fight stress. Magnesium, chromium, iron, copper, zinc, manganese, and phosphorus. In those seven minerals is probably the most important array of stress-fighting types of compounds that we can have. For example, when we take in magnesium, our body uses that to regulate hormone cycles, regulate brain function, regulate our heart, and these are all things that are affected by stress. We could say the same with chromium. Whenever we're stressed out, our blood sugar fires off wildly. Chromium normalizes blood sugar and helps us remain even keel, not only in our blood sugar level, but that also affects the way our brain is functioning. If our blood sugar is straight and clean and even keel, generally we can function at a high level, we can perform at a high level. If it's fluctuating wildly, we can have mood swings, behavioral disorders, or we can even get into a place where we can't sit down and do a day's work, or even these other problems that we're dealing with neurologically in our civilization. Now, going beyond that, there's a whole class of superfoods that come from the microalgae world, and this is an area where I've had a lot of research experience and done a lot of personal science. I'm also a scientist as a hobby, and one of these areas is in this area of marine phytoplankton. Now, I'm going to say something here that is very profound. Again, what we can do is we can learn from where I've been, which is at the fringes of this area of nutrition. I'm bringing back now this substance called marine phytoplankton, and now it's available online. All kinds of online health food stores have it, and pretty soon it's going to be in all the health food stores, the brick-and-mortar stores. This stuff was originally isolated and stated by Jacques Cousteau to be the future of nutrition. It's the basis of the entire food chain of the entire world. Now, what's in these little organisms, the marine phytoplankton, is actually nucleotides. Now, what the heck is a nucleotide? A nucleotide is ATP. Now, we know in the nutrition world, and some people who've been educated in it do realize that when you eat food, protein, fat, and carbohydrates, your body has to convert those protein, fat, and carbohydrates into a form that can produce energy. That's the mitochondria taking that fat, carbohydrate, and protein and putting it into energy packets we call ATP. And that's the energy currency of our body. Another way of describing this is that it's like we're taking in British pounds, pun intended, and then we have to convert it to U.S. dollars in order to actually use it as energy. when we take in marine phytoplankton, we bypass the entire mitochondria cycle, the whole Krebs cycle, the conversion to energy. It actually has ATP or nucleotides like GTP, GDP, ADP that are already energy packets, and that means we get something very interesting, which is energy without stimulation. So there's energy, but it's not coming from carbohydrates. It's not coming from burning fats and oils. It's not coming from protein. It's actually coming from the direct energy packets themselves. Now, that phenomenon right there is what can allow me, if I really have to work hard, and sometimes I do have to burn the midnight oil and stay up all night and then work through the next day or do that for 2 days in a row, I can do that without trashing or crashing my immune system. Because marine phytoplankton, I'll just dose up on that. I'll take, you know, 4 or 5 times the normal dosage, and that will keep me up all night, but not stimulated. So I'm not. It's not like a stimulant. Like I had to drink coffee to stay up all night or took caffeine.
So wait. Secretly, David, you're not like slamming down gallons of Starbucks and stuff?
Right. I've never. You know what's crazy about that is, growing up in the way that I did, my parents are very health-oriented, just kind of by default. I mean, they never were into health food, but they never drank alcohol. They never drank coffee, so I never was around it. And it
have you ever had a cup of coffee?
I've never had a cup of coffee in my life.
Interesting. And so I don't believe there's any such thing as a healthy coffee, or is there?
Well, it could be done healthier. How's that?
Okay. Let's go back to the marine, though, phytoplankton, you're saying fascinating stuff here.
It's fascinating because it really is. It's the cutting edge. And what I love about it and where we're at now is this is entirely natural. There's no synthetic chemicals, there's no, you know, hidden ingredients, there's no gelatin added in, there's no stuff going on in laboratories that's creating and isolating certain substances and adding that in. Nothing like that. Entirely natural, but yet at the cutting edge. So it's ancient old, but brand new. And that is really what I'm always striving for, that concept. Anyway, so this marine phytoplankton and all microalgaes, like chlorella, you know, the Koreans have popularized chlorella worldwide, and it's now a mega industry worldwide, spirulina, blue-green algae, these are all microalgaes that are all the best protein sources in the world. They're 60 to 65% protein. Some research I've seen says 70% protein. They're complete protein sources. They're highly bioavailable if they agree with you. And again, not every food or superfood is for everybody, but great that we have the choice. And what we can do with these things is we can begin to access not only that protein, not only the ATP, but there's another piece of the puzzle, and that is spirulina and blue-green algae contain blue pigments, which have been isolated as phycocyanin. That's the name of that compound, the blue pigments that's in these things. This phycocyanin causes us to secrete a huge amount of stem cells. Now, stem cells are involved in rejuvenation and youthening. Now, if we are able to take in, let's listen closely to what I'm about to say here, because this is something anybody can do. I'm working with companies right now designing products like this for the marketplace. Listen to where we're at now. You could take the phycocyanin, which is just the blue pigments of algae. You could literally spin the algae in a giant vortex and separate off the layers of the different pigments, and you just pull it so there's no chemistry involved. You pull the blue pigments off. You dry those. You mix them with medicinal mushrooms. This is another great superfood in the world. Reishi mushroom, shaga mushroom, maitake mushroom. These are apparently, in my experience and from the research I've seen, and I work with the top mycologists in the world, these are the number one things for our immune system. When you take in a reishi mushroom, which is top in Chinese medicine for our immune system, or shaga, top in Russian history for the immune system, you take these things in with the blue pigment of the algae, the phycocyanin, and together you get a tripling of the immune power of that mushroom, a tripling right there. If you do one more step, you add a natural form of vitamin C, like rosehip powder or acerola cherry powder or amalaki or amla berry powder, or if you were to take, let's just say, camu berry powder. These things are all available online and in health food stores, natural vitamin C's instead of an isolate. It's the natural form. And then you mix that with those other two ingredients. So when now we have the blue pigments of algae, we have the medicinal mushroom like reishi and shaga, and then we've got the vitamin C, you can triple the efficacy of all that again on your immune system. So you can ninefold increase the power of the most powerful immune system substance we know of, which is, let's just say, reishi mushroom. You can ninefold increase its efficacy just by mixing it with other things.
Now, let me say this, too, because I could imagine a lot of people listening to this going, oh, my God, you know, this sounds great, But how the heck do you do that? Where do you learn on how to actually combine and put all this stuff together? It's kind of a loaded question, of course, but
yeah. Well, there's the one way that I've done it in my books is just give people recipes. You know, so throw one teaspoon of this in here, and then I'll give like a brand name, where to get it. There's plenty of websites to get this stuff. But what I'm doing now, because I want to make it easier for people, is I'm working with companies as a consultant in order to design formulas that go online or into health food stores that where it's already done for you.
Gotcha.
That's what we want, right? We want it just, you know, okay, I'll take it, but what, you know, you do it, which is that's my goal. That's
well,
my goal.
I was not going to immediately become a gardener today. That's for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
Not that there's anything wrong with that. Actually, I think there's a serene, tranquil sort of being that that I would probably become if I actually spent a little bit of time in a garden. I think it would be extremely cool. However, you know, there's this thing of how certain people's lives are set up that would preclude them from doing that. So, yeah, and I wanted to say that you do have a lot of this laid out on your website and your books and everything. So I just want people to understand that while you're recommending and explaining why and how, that you've also set it up so that people can – it's put together for them if they want to follow the advice that you're giving here.
Right, and I've also done lots of videos that are available for free online, YouTube, et cetera, where you can see how it's done just with a simple blender. So that's kind of fun, too, is be able to actually visually see it. So I'm always attempting to meet people's needs in an audio format, video format, and through my books and other media information that's in a text format.
Okay, let me for just a second. I'll have you give out some resources at the when we're done here. Where would people go to watch you put together some of the videos, like putting what you're sharing right now?
Well, you could just get onto YouTube and you could punch up David Wolfe smoothie. Literally, just those words right there. YouTube. If you remember from Engage 2009, that Engage Today event, YouTube is the second biggest search engine online. And so I took advantage of that years ago and just put up a whole bunch of free videos up there. And there's a bunch of me doing smoothies, David Wolfe smoothie. And, again, that will bring up several videos to help educate yourself on how to put this stuff together with a blender. And one of the things about this blender thing is all we're doing is we're just upgrading the old idea of the blender, which is a banana, some frozen blueberries, water, and a protein, you know, powder. We're just saying, okay, move the protein powder out, move the superfoods in. That's all the only change that's required, and you don't even need to know a whole bunch about that. Just try it. Just throw, you know, a handful of goji berries in there, 5 or 6 cacao beans in there, a little tablespoon of maca in there, and, you know, maybe some marine phytoplankton, a teaspoon of marine phytoplankton, and blend that up instead of the whey protein, for example, and see what happens to you. And that's how we're starting people up, and that's really, I think, what's getting the most results for us right now is just that simple idea.
Well, you got to be asked the question about how much protein, probably more than probably anything. Like, well, where do you get your protein from? So you just said something really important. So you're saying instead of, and I was going to ask you about whey protein. Like, whey protein is made out of milk, or at least comes from. What about protein? So your protein, does it really come from smoothies, or does it come from the things you actually chew?
Right.
I mean, I know you actually chew your juice. Let's talk about that also, since I'm on that subject. Don't you love how I ask you questions that are like 4 different questions in one minute?
Coming from all different directions.
Yeah, well, there's so much to this. This is like one of these things where there's so many things I'd love to ask you. We could really spend 10 hours talking about all this. So protein, how much protein does a human body need? Let's start with that and then where to get it.
Okay, Max Planck Institute did a study on protein. They found out when you cook the protein, let's say we have a juicy steak, we cook it, boom, we lose 50% of the protein straight away. 50% becomes unusable. From that research, it isn't a big jump to go to the realization of, uh-oh, maybe our protein requirements are inflated by a factor of 2 because we're cooking everything. So if we could just, you know, get protein in its raw state, maybe we can get all the protein that we need, and all we need is half as much. Well, my feeling is we probably are inflating it by a factor of 3, because when you have raw protein, let's say it's spirulina, again, a complete protein source, pretty much all the superfoods, goji berries, spirulina, marine phytoplankton, bee pollen, hemp seed, blue-green algae, and, you know, there's a whole list of maca. These are all complete protein sources already. And they're highly bioavailable. They're time-proven over thousands of years to work, which is amazing. And they give you, for sure for the first time actually complete protein. Now, what do I mean by that? Like somebody says, like, well, I eat bologna sandwiches every day. I'm getting complete protein. What do you mean I'm first time ever? Well, my belief is that some of the amino acids in the protein chains that form, you know, our meat today are degraded very quickly by heat. One of them, of course, is tryptophan. And tryptophan is, you know, obviously creates all the tryptamine chemicals like serotonin that creates feelings of well-being. If we don't get enough tryptophan in our diet, which a lot of people aren't, even though they're eating quote-unquote protein-rich foods, then that can lead on to the symptomology of what we call depression, chemical depression, because we're not getting the right nutrients and therefore we're depressed. So when you put all that together, you start to realize, wait a second, what I'm talking about here is an insurance policy. When I say get onto superfoods, I'm saying you want to make sure you're getting what you actually need. Take in the top thing out of Chinese medicine, the top thing out of the Andes, the top thing coming out of the Amazon, acai in that case, by the way, the top thing coming out of Polynesia, noni, the top thing coming out of, say, North America, the AFA blue-green algae, and you literally mix all that together in one drink as your protein drink, but it really is more like an insurance policy to guarantee that you really are getting enough protein. Now, how do we feel protein? That's an important one, too, because people think, oh, protein muscles, that's it, right? It's like for muscles. No, the number one symptom of a protein problem is neurological disorders, brain chemistry distortions, problems with proper brain functioning, ADD, ADHD. That kind of phenomenon is actually protein deficiency. How could that be occurring in a civilization that eats as much meat as we do? Well, we're not actually getting that much protein from that meat, and what we are getting is very poor quality. When we get superfoods added in, I'm not saying take the meat away, let somebody do that on their own volition, but what I'm saying here, add this in as an insurance policy to make sure you're getting what you need to get your brain to function properly. And what I find is, having started people on that for years, is that is a very powerful first step, because people go, whoa, I'm feeling it. I feel something is different. What the heck's going on with this? And that inspires them, of course, to take the next step and to begin to research more completely and deeply.
Wow. You know what? What about people that lift weights and really want to put on size? Have you ever seen a raw food eater that can actually have the physique of, say, a bodybuilder? Not like a thin, skinny bodybuilder, but I'm saying a really muscular person. Is that even possible on a raw food diet?
It's possible, but it's got to be done correctly, and it's got to be done in a way where all tools are utilized. Because obviously, plant-based protein and just plant nutrients in general are not as densely packed as what you're going to find from animal foods. I'm thinking of my friend Marcus Patrick. You know, Marcus Patrick is, you can Google him, by the way. He is, you know, an actor, a model. He was in, like, Days of Our Lives, one of these crazy soap operas. He's a really good friend of mine. But this guy is absolutely ripped. I mean, he is ripped. Like, you look at him and go, you know, my God, how in the world can anybody have a physique like that? It's one of those situations. It's almost freakish. He's one of the fastest human beings in the world. He can jump over a car doing a flying kick from a running start. I mean, it's like Superman. It's like superhuman. When you get somebody like that onto raw foods, yes, it's possible to develop a physique like that. You can just Google pictures of him and have a look, or even email him or contact him and say, what in the heck are you up to? Because he's more than happy to spread the good news. I wouldn't say you could build a physique like that with watermelons and lettuce. You know, there's just not enough substance there.
So, like, David, what would be, like, the perfect protein shake? I know you kind of already sort of explained that, but what would be the ideal shake that contains all of the the best proteins a human body could consume?
Okay, well, it's going to be different slightly for everybody because we all differ metabolically. You know, some people can handle the spirulina protein. Some people can't. Some people can handle hemp protein. Some people can't. But I'll give you a basic idea of what it looks like. We got our blender, so we've got that sitting in front of us. We've got to figure out what our base is going to be, what's going to be the liquid in there. I used water for years when I first got into doing this kind of stuff. I've used coconut water, which is a wonderful base, especially if you're living like where you're at in Tempe, Arizona, you know, where it's warmer most of the time. It's a great base. When I'm up here in the far north, I use a tea that I've made with spring water on my wood-burning stove out of the wild mushrooms from the forest here, and I'll use that as a base. Now, you go, wild mushrooms, what the heck? I'm not using that. Well, you could use green tea. You know, you could just use that as the base. You can use cold green tea or warm green tea. Generally, cold is kind of interesting and fun to do, or green tea with vanilla. made into a cool, like you make that tea, then put it in the back of your fridge, get it out the next day, and it's nice and cool, and it's a cooling tonic, wonderful base for a smoothie. So we have our liquid base. Then we've got to go, okay, what are we going to put in here in terms of, like, nutrients? Well, we want to accelerate the absorption of nutrients, so therefore I always recommend that we add berries into our smoothie. Blueberries and raspberries are fine. One or the other or both or blackberries or whatever ones you have. Goji berries, wonderful. Throw that in there. Goji berry is really has all benefits because it not only helps you absorb all the nutrients and the protein and the vitamin C, but it itself is a complete protein source. Let's say we wanted to design this drink to have a little bit of a chocolate flavor or chocolate flair. So we're going to have a little bit of chocolate in our protein drink. Now, this is something that all the big protein industry people know, and that is that chocolate actually increases your rate of absorption of the actual protein and the nutrients that you're blending it with. That's why chocolate is always provided as a choice in different slim bars and different protein designer shake things and all this kind of stuff. There's a chocolate additive because chocolate, again, helps with absorption, and it dilates our capillaries, allows those nutrients to get in. So I would use just raw cacao beans, which are real easy to get, and you could just literally, or nibs, which are broken pieces of the beans. It's not really a bean, again. It's a nut, like an almond. It's the most widely eaten nut in the world, but we don't eat it in its natural state until now. So we get that. We throw that in there. Maybe we throw 5-10 of those in there. Then we take something that's going to be the bottom end of the drink, a fat. We need something, you know, that thickens it up. Now, in the old days, it was milk. We take milk and pour it in there. Obviously, due to the dubious quality of dairy products in general and the allergies that are going on, I don't really recommend dairy anymore. So what I would recommend is using something like almonds. So I just take literally raw almonds. I'll throw 15 raw almonds in there. Then I will put in the protein fraction, which is going to be the superfoods. What do those look like? Well, I like maca because it's a protein preloader. It's got the hormonal piece in there, which helps the actual protein to be absorbed and utilized. We have hormones pumping through our body, like testosterone. We obviously know the impact on that on our physique and on our overall power and strength. So we're going to put maca in there. We're going to put in, I've already mentioned goji berries, we're going to put in a selection of these different microalgae. Let's say we're really into chlorella. Boom, I'll throw a bunch of chlorella in there. I'll throw a bunch of hemp protein in there. Why hemp protein instead of a whey protein? Again, it's just more natural, more original, more pure, easier to control. You know what you're getting exactly. So we put that in there. I will throw in there, I like putting in the medicinal mushrooms, like these mushroom powders that are available at every health food store in North America. Reishi mushroom, for example. Now, you'd say, well, is that protein? That can be anywhere from 20 to 40% protein, which is very high for a plant-based source of protein. And it's also immunomodulating, so it helps with our immune system. So I'll put that in there as well. And then I've got to start thinking about, okay, I want to make it taste good. I want to use a sweetener. What's a sweetener that is natural, simple, healthy, and that we know, you know, helps deliver nutrients? Of course, the answer to that is honey. So I'm, as a beekeeper myself, I'm, of course, partial to honey and honeybees. So I will put in 2 dollops of honey into that drink. And if I have bee pollen, which is a complete protein source, I'll throw that in there as well. And there we've got a pretty good little protein drink going, with chlorella and hemp protein being our primary proteins in this particular case. You blend that up. Here's the key ingredient, key piece to smoothie making. You blend that up, hopefully with a high-speed blender, but it doesn't have to be. High-speed blender like Vitamix is what I recommend. You pour that through a strainer, really good tool to have in your kitchen, so you don't get all those particles and pieces of the fiber from the almonds, for example, and then it comes through smooth, and then you drink that, and you've got a creamy milkshake. It's a creamy chocolate milkshake that's meeting your protein needs. It's all liquefied. We know exactly what we got. There's no chemicals that have snuck in, and we've become our own smoothie machine, our own smoothie company, so to speak. And then we can tweak that to our own metabolism depending on what we like and what works for our body.
Well, that sounds pretty fantastic. So let me ask you a question about you blend something up. Say you make a whole bunch of it. What's the shelf life of raw foods after you've blended it and you've broken it down? I mean, how you put it in the fridge? I mean, to what degree? When does it go bad?
That's a very good question. With these superfoods, because one of the hallmarks of all superfoods is their extraordinary antioxidant content, I mentioned already the goji berry's antioxidant content, one of the highest in the world. The highest in the world is chocolate. It's the highest antioxidant superfood in the world. So when you blend these things together, goji berries, the blueberries, the cacao, you get such high level of antioxidants in that smoothie that it will last 3 days or longer in the fridge. So you can
even if it's mixed, does like the antioxidants in a chocolate, does it preserve the other foods because they're mixed together, or is that how it works?
You're right. What's really happening is that when we blend in the almonds or the cacao, as the oil is liberated from the fiber, and the oil has a huge amount of the antioxidant properties of almonds and cacao beans, that oil then coats all the ingredients and shields it from oxidation.
Interesting. And so when you say strain out of the, is that more for taste or more for how it affects your digestion of it?
It's a little bit easier to digest because if we just gulp down a bunch of undigested fiber, let's say from the skins of almonds, that's not really good. You know, you can get a tummy ache if you do that too fast. At the same time, I like the smoothness of pouring it through a strainer. It just takes it makes it a much more noble experience of drinking that beverage because you're not like chewing little things that are in there or having to filter through like, you know, pieces of like, you know, a nut that's in there that suddenly you got that in your mouth. You know what I mean? It just makes it smoother and easier to deal with.
So you mentioned on a video I watched about chewing helps with stress and that I believe it creates serotonin production. And you also mentioned chewing your juice. So when you're actually drinking it, you're still moving your mouth and you're chewing. Could you explain how that response is created?
Yeah, you want to always alert your bodies to what's coming. The general idea is chewing your juice, which means mixing the juice a little bit or the blended food a little bit with your saliva. So you get that reaction, you know, so your body goes, okay, we know what's coming, we know how to deal with it, and you get a secretion of enzymes that occurs in your saliva almost instantaneously to the juice or the blended drink. I really believe in drinking these things slowly and letting them absorb slowly. I've learned to do that over the years. Here's the trick that I did when I was younger, because obviously I would make stuff that would taste so good, I'd just literally drink the whole thing in like 5 minutes. Which isn't, you know, that's a lot of suddenly you have a blender full, which is like a liter of blended drink right in your gut in 5 minutes is not really a great way to absorb this stuff because you're just too much too fast. So what I used to do is I used to add cayenne pepper into the actual blended drink so that I couldn't drink it very fast because it would be too hot. So that was a little strategy that I used. Now I'm at a point where that doesn't happen to me much. You know, I can just kind of sip on stuff all day. But sometimes it's clever to use these tools, like cayenne pepper, to stave off our own indiscretions.
Now, you were what I want to go back to because is making sure that you've written a whole book, Superfood. So you go into great detail with these different superfoods. But I wanted to see if there's any other things that you wanted to mention because in the middle of it, I know I asked you about protein and that sort of stuff. What I'd like to really have you address is what about people Thanksgiving dinner, you know, Christmas dinner. Going out and eating with friends. I mean, all of the social aspects of eating, and people are going to prepare a big meal. I mean, how does one contend with all of that if they want to live and eat this way?
Well, one thing you don't ever want to do is make the mistakes that I made, which is, you know, you make food a war at your house, and, you know, you battle with your parents and your brothers and everything else about what you're going to eat at that house. So I let that go years ago because obviously it was a losing proposition all the way along, and I learned the hard way that the best way to deal with this is be very kind and gentle to yourself and others. There's no need to force anything about down anybody's throat. If you're the health person in your family, and I have seen in numbers of cases where the most unhealthy person in the family and the most overweight person in the family becomes the healthiest person in the family. If that's you or is going to be you, one of the things you can do is you bring the health food to the dinner. You bring the salad, for example, to the Thanksgiving dinner, and you bring the dessert. And you'll hook them on the dessert because these raw food desserts that are made with real raw chocolate and superfoods like maca and that have used almond nuts as the crust and that, you know, are filled with, like, these different fillings like dried figs and other fantastically delicious things, get people. I mean, people eat these raw desserts and they're like, wait a second, this is like no chemicals, it's organic, and I can eat as much as I want with no side effects. I mean, it's really like a revelation. So if you start bringing that stuff, first of all, everybody's going to want what you're having. Second of all, you're going to win their hearts and also their minds, because they'll start going, well, what is up with this raw ice cream? You know, what's going on with this raw dessert cake thing here? You know, what's the deal with a salad? I mean, you put avocado in your salad, it's amazing. You know, and you'll start getting that reaction instead of the reaction of like, no, you're the health freak, go away.
Yeah, and you probably went through that whole stage in your life, as I believe a lot of people probably have to kind of figure that out.
Yeah, I just don't want anybody to make the mistakes that I made, and a lot of people in the industry who've been in it as long as I have, you know, we all made these mistakes, and until now, it's a little bit different. You know, the market has changed quite a bit. We've realized that diets really don't work. What we really want to do is we want to add in the good stuff, the natural stuff, let it naturally crowd out the bad stuff just by flavor alone, let alone the nutrients and the other side effects of, you know, eating the best foods in the world. We go towards a more natural approach instead of an aggressive, like, you know, I'm the health guy, I don't eat that, you need to get that poisonous food away from me, or any of that nonsense. So we're just becoming more mature in our perspective about diets. I know certainly I am becoming more mature, and I'm also becoming more aware of how we have to reach people, because people are hurting. There's a lot of people who are very ill, they want help, they want to change their diet, and they just don't know how. And so my goal is to give as many tools as possible on how to do that.
What does your kitchen look like? I mean, what are must-haves that every kitchen should have? Even if someone's not, you know, going to go 100% raw, what are some things? You mentioned a Vitamix blender.
Vitamix blender, definitely.
Amazing.
Yep.
I have one in my office, I have one in my house. I mean, they're unbelievable. What are some other things?
Okay, so other things that you should have is, I would really recommend Salad Master cookware, because you're going to be using, for example, like say you make teas, or you're going to be making anything for anybody in your family, you're cooking anything. Salad Master 316T stainless steel is the only stainless steel and the only cookware ever developed by humankind that outgasses no toxic minerals into the foods or substances or water that you're using in your cookware. So I want to put that out there. I don't have anything to do with Salad Master. I mean, I love the company, you know, but I'm very, very impressed with their products. Very impressed. You can also have different food processors that dice up your cabbage and your carrots and all that kind of stuff, all kinds of things like that. In terms of the array of how our kitchen is set up, we have to get out of this Betty Crocker idea of the kitchen with all the cabinets and you can't find anything. We got to get all the cabinet doors open or off or see-through so that we can see what we've got. The same with our refrigerator. Let's get everything so it's organized so we can see what we've got. And what I have is a wide array of, right in front of me here, I have about 5 different types of honey, most of them local and some of them our own honey. I've got all my bee pollen products and royal jelly and propolis extracts, all that's with the honey. So I have my whole honey hive product area. I've got my chocolate area, so I've got my cacao beans. I've got my raw cacao powder. I've got different little raw chocolates that we've made up in jars and stuff, and that's all in one section. Then I have my nuts, all of that's in one section. So that's almonds, pecans, and cashews, which are my favorite ones. So I have those around. Of course, you can have more than that if you like them. I've got my seaweeds in giant glass containers with a top that is really cool. It kind of pulls off. You can get this at the container store, just a big glass container with a metal lid. And I've got all my seaweeds packed up in there, like dulse and nori and kelp and some of the great seaweeds that we've known about from sushi restaurants. Well, you can bring these things home and make fantastic salads out of them or just snack on them. We call it salt gum. It's kind of like chewing on beef jerky, but it's seaweed. Then I've got my olive oils, and I, you know, of course, I'm an olive oil, you know, aficionado. I love really high quality food, obviously, and I love very high quality olive oil. So I've got my olive oils out. Everything is out. I've also got my natural sea salts. I've got my natural rock salts. You know, they're from natural deposits in the earth, and I'd never use any kind of processed Morton's iodized salt or anything like that. What else do I have? I have a big mortar and pestle, a stone mortar and pestle, so that I can take herbs, crush them to a powder with like stone stone on stone. That took me a long time to actually get the right tool, but I went to Chinatown, got the right tool, and it's just a big 8-inch mortar and pestle so I can crush things to a powder and make really amazing garnishes. For example, I can take one of the local, or I can just take, say, cacao beans. That's an easy one to do. And crush it, instead of in a blender, I can crush it stone on stone with a mortar and pestle and create like this powdered kind of natural cacao bean, and then sprinkle that onto a dessert and give a really interesting garnish to a dessert. So it, you know, has that flavor and design of a professional chef, even though I'm not really a professional chef, but I have learned from some great chefs. So I do stuff like that for that reason. I have also my favorite Aqua Ovo water dispenser, which is an egg-shaped water dispenser. You just throw your water on top of it, and it sits on a giant egg, and when you pull it, it pulls like a draft beer. It's beautifully designed. It's out of Montreal, Quebec, and I highly recommend that product. So that's kind of a quick rundown. Tools-wise, I have ceramic knives. Only that's what we use here, is ceramic knives, not metal knives, because when you cut oranges, for example, the vitamin C is degraded by the metal instantly on contact. It's an electrical phenomenon, and it destroys about 50% of the vitamin C. When you cut it with a ceramic knife, you get none of that degradation at all. And ceramic is just a better tool in general for playing around with food, because there is a subtle electromagnetic phenomenon that occurs when you cut food up, even a tomato, with a metal knife. So I have my ceramic knives. I've got a whole basket full of chopsticks. I love the idea of chopsticks because it causes us to eat slowly, which is a great thing we can all benefit from. So we have a whole thing of chopsticks here. And wooden artifacts and wooden ladles. I mostly collect wooden stuff when I travel around the world because it's natural and it's original, and I don't have to worry about, you know, any weird stuff in the metals. You know, like nickel, for example, can outgas and get into your water, it can get into your food, it can get into your body, which we don't want. It's a heavy metal. Cutting boards. I have all wooden cutting boards, and I have several different ones. I've collected them over the years. People send me them. Got great ones. The one I'm using now is shaped like an apple, so I use a wooden cutting board. And then we have three, and one thing I want to say about my kitchen, we have three different types of trash in my kitchen. We have landfill, four different types. We have landfill, we have plastic recycling, glass recycling, and then compost. So most of the stuff that's out of here we're recycling in some way, or we're at least ethically disposing of it. I'm a very big believer in green businesses. I've run green businesses my whole career, and I think we need to spend the extra money to do things the right way.
Well, I mean, that's quite a list. What about juicers and stuff? I mean, what brand do you do? What do you use for juicing? How often do you juice?
Well, I'd love to juice more, but I have a weakness with cleaning the juicer. So most of the time that I get juices, it's being made for me at a health food store. I have a Green Star juicer, which is, I believe it's a Korean company actually, puts together. It's a trituration juicer, which means that it basically pushes the celery, the carrot, between two gears that kind of crush the celery or the carrot, and that's a really good juicer. Of course, you know, I'm a big fan of Jack LaLanne, and he's got this juicer on TV. Literally throw an entire apple right into the juicer and just shoot and blend it down. There's a lot of oxidation that occurs with kind of a juicer, and for that reason, you know, I like the trituration types of juicers better, but then, you know, you balance it off with what's easier to use, and that Jack LaLanne type of juicer is easier to use. The main thing about juicing is people ask me, which one should I get? How should I get, you know, what juicer should I use? And the best juicer is always the one that's in your cabinet that you've never opened or used yet. Use that one till it breaks, then get a good one.
Yes, well, I will say the Green Star juicer, I did have one, and it was such a pain in the butt to clean for me. I mean, obviously, I'm sort of a guy that's would fit the profile of a ADD, type A, fast-paced, impatient sort of entrepreneur, which is probably a sole function of eating the wrong foods after talking with you. However, there's a lot of work involved in cleaning it up. So part of this is setting it up in a way to where you're actually going to use it. And I buy lots of gadgets because, I'm just that way. And so I think absolutely everyone should own a Vitamix. I have nothing to do with that company. I just think they're fantastic tools. And it was interesting, some of the things you said about ceramic knives, olive oils, you know, what about olive oils versus other oils?
Over the years, the research for me has kind of isolated three oils that are above everything else. One of them is olive oil, and they vary tremendously in quality. I've had some of the best olive oil in the world made off of trees that were producing olives after there were literally trees 3,000 years old. That's some stuff that comes off of the island of Crete, you know, in Greece. So wow. Olive oil definitely is excellent, but it's got to be quality. Next one, of course, is coconut oil, which has use not only in the kitchen. You can use it when you come out of the shower. And if you're really clever, you can use it with your husband, wife, partner, significant other, or whatever. And I think you know where that conversation goes.
Let's spend 10 minutes just on that one. No, let's get it.
So coconut oil is doing wonders for marriages and relationships all over the planet. Definitely
wow.
worth mentioning. And then another one is hemp seed oil, because it has the appropriate ratio of omega-3. It has appropriate ratio of all of omega-3, omega-6, omega-9, gamma-linolenic acid, which is an anti-inflammatory fatty acid. It's got a rich array of minerals and is generally more in balance than, for example, flaxseed oil. So those are the three that I really strongly recommend.
Well, let's say someone was going to go to a movie and order a movie theater popcorn. What are they putting in their body?
Well, the corn today, about 90% of it is genetically modified. Now, what the genetically modified gene is doing is it's creating a compound called glufosinates, and those connect into and disturb our natural bacteria in our digestive tract. So it actually screws up our natural friendly probiotic bacteria that helps us digest food, because those glufosinates are naturally antibiotics. They're actually killing off friendly and unfriendly organisms. So that's one thing we're exposing ourselves to. Then we're exposing ourselves to the congealed shell of the corn, which, you know, people have seen that come all the way through their body and come out the other side. This has been implicated in creating potential for diverticulitis, because sometimes that corn gets stuck inside our digestive system, the actual hardened shell piece of it, and which we don't digest, obviously, because it comes through us. And that can be problematic and create, you know, all kinds of digestive distress and even lead to allergies, I might add, because if we have an irritation in our digestive tract in our intestines, this can actually ramp its way up into actually becoming allergic to everything. We go and get a colonic, and all of a sudden, boom, all that stuff comes out, and the allergy goes away. I've seen that happen to numerous people, and I just want to put it out there because it is common. What else is happening? Well, we have the butter. Well, that's not even butter anymore. That's a synthetic. Usually it's a margarine. Margarine is actually a solid above your body temperature, which makes it very dangerous because your body cannot melt it unless it creates a fever-like condition. I think margarine and vegetable-based processed rancid oils are probably the worst thing to put in our body of any single thing. If you had to ask me what's the worst of the worst, I think that's actually the worst.
Interesting. Well, what about microwaves? You don't have a microwave in your kitchen, obviously.
I don't have a microwave. I'll tell you what I did do, though, which is fun, is I took my old microwave and I used it. Obviously, it wasn't plugged in, but I used it for substances that I was working with in chemistry experiments that needed to be protected from EMF fields. So if you put that in the microwave, right, because the microwave oven is shielded pretty significantly as compared to anything else, you can actually keep substances in there and keep them from being affected by EMF fields. So, you know, there is a use for these things, but not the one we're being told about.
That is hysterical. Let's see if there's any other questions. What about calories? I mean, do you count calories? Do you look at that? Is that something people should concern themselves with?
The calorie idea has some beneficial – there's some beneficial things that can come out of the calorie idea. Here's what I mean. For example, like people say, well, you know, what in the world are you, like, eating? Like, you know, I can't survive on sprouts. I'll wither away. Well, in my diet, I do have substances that have calories – nuts, seeds, nut butters, some superfoods like goji berries, which means that they have a significant quantity of substance. They have a significant quantity of fat and protein. So that's what really calories means to me. The amount of those calories that I take in, I'm 185-pound, 6-foot-tall male, so you would be shocked at actually how many calories I take in every day, which is sometimes it's less than 1,000. It's usually less than 2,000.
And is it because the nutrition is so dense
yes.
that you just...
Yes, it's because the quality is higher, so I don't need as much calories.
Now, I would imagine for someone to actually live that way, if they've been, say, like on a a standard American diet that consists of either a little bit or a lot of junk food, or they're a clean eater, but they've eaten a lot of, you know, protein and pastas and various other things, that there's going to be a transition period in their body where they could even absorb that. Would that be accurate?
That's accurate, right? So what the dietary transition really is about, and this is the other piece on calories, what it's really about is transitioning over where your main calorie sources are coming from. So, for example, the average person just out there in the world, we're getting a huge amount of calorie sources from fat and protein, from meat. We're getting it from dairy. We're getting it from carbohydrates like bread or pasta. You know, so those are where we're – and out of those, generally, a person is centering their primary nutrition around one of those areas. It's usually, you know, meat. That is their primary source of calories or fuel. To shift that over, for example, to nuts and seeds and avocados and olives and olive oil and that kind of stuff takes some time. But it is ultimately – it definitely takes, you know, some adjustment, but it is ultimately what a raw food diet really is. Ultimately, what it is just shifting your primary calorie source away from, say, you know, cooked meat or processed dairy over to raw food sources. And in general, in the raw plant world, it's going to be nuts and seeds and avocados and olives and oils, you know, that have, and perhaps also some superfoods like goji berries that have some caloric value.
What about people that are just total carb addicts, just consume lots of carbs, or simply psychologically, you know, I mean, when I use the term addict, I want to be sensitive to that word because I think there's a tremendous amount of addiction as it relates to food. I mean, it is beyond people's ability to use willpower to control. I mean, they are psychologically, it's a drug.
Exactly, and there's a lot of factors there. There are social factors, there are emotional factors. There are factors of peer pressure, and then one thing I want to bring up is there are also factors of metabolism, and that is it's possible that there's two factors in metabolism. One is if we eat a food that we are allergic to excessively, we can actually become addicted to that food. This is known with alcoholics, for example. Alcoholics are almost all allergic to alcohol, but part of that allergic response is the addiction to the drug or the food. Now, the other piece of that metabolic equation is there are organisms that like that sugar. They like carbocoma. They want to be knocked out with massive amounts of carbohydrates. And those organisms are what we call candida, fungus, yeast, mold organisms, which can overwhelm our friendly bacteria in our digestive tract, create all sorts of health problems, and in fact can even, you know, create changes in our thought patterns in order for us to become like focused on eating more sugar to feed them. They can affect our thoughts.
So what does one do in order to transition from that? Say you're eating a tremendous amount of starchy carbs, you know, pastas, breads, you know, what are good carbs, what are bad carbs from your perspective?
Okay, let's go into good carbs and bad carbs. Good carbs, in my opinion, are – this is so profound, what I'm about to say, it's ridiculous. It's actually polysaccharides, medicinal polysaccharides that come from superfoods and some of the great super herbs, aloe vera, noni, reishi mushroom, maitake mushroom, shiitake mushroom. These polysaccharides, like beta-glucans, which has been isolated also in oats and several other different types of grains, these polysaccharides have very powerful medicinal immunomodulating effects. At the same time, they're antifungal, so they fight off some of this candida, and they give us long-term energy. So if you want to say what's the best carb of them all, it's definitely polysaccharides for sure, and there are numerous amounts of them. In fact, you know, there's whole books written on this subject now just on what we call essential sugars. Short-chain sugars like glucose and fructose that are naturally found in berries would be my second pick. And when you start getting into, like, very heavily domesticated apples and pears and oranges, we start getting to a little bit, and banana, you start getting a little bit more sugar than would be naturally possible, but that's still at least natural. It's a natural form of sugar and better than reaching for candy. So that's some of, you know, some information on that. Now, how do we transition over? One of the best ways to transition over is to start taking these medicinal mushroom capsules in our diet. And this is one of the recommendations that always leads the front of the list for me, for everybody. They work for a large amount of the population. They're extremely and heavily tested and researched scientifically. They are very effective at fighting off fungal infections and keeping candida in check, and they give us that long-chain polysaccharide, which is a great carbohydrate for fuel.
Gotcha, gotcha. What about alkalinity? Because I've heard with some, like, you know, people that without certain alkaline diets don't ever eat mushrooms. I mean, what are your thoughts on that sort of stuff?
It's so funny. The people who write those books, they send spies to my seminars to find out what in the world is going on with medicinal mushrooms. Because what they're talking about, and they have an excellent point, they're talking about button mushrooms and mushrooms that you buy in a store that are, you know, on the rack at the local produce section. And what happens with those button mushrooms is that they can get spores of mold underneath their gills, and they usually are contaminated with mold because they're driven around in trucks and they're grown in places that are contaminated with mold, and therefore they can actually create allergic reactions in people or immunocollapsing reactions. And I don't really recommend mushrooms like that. In fact, I really don't recommend for the average layman out there or laywoman out there any mushrooms that come from the ground. I only recommend medicinal mushrooms which come from trees, which are the noble messengers of the family of all mushrooms on this earth. They're the most perfect medicines for us. They're beautiful to look at. I just found some the other day out here in the forest behind my house. They're just absolutely gorgeous. They're extremely medicinal. They have a tremendous research history behind them. And at the same time, they're able to fit into our daily lifestyle today because we can just take these mushroom capsules, which we call techno mushrooms. We don't even have to process them, you know, the way that our ancestors did.
Where would someone get some of those? I mean, how would they go shopping for medicinal mushrooms? Do you want to give out some websites or anything?
Sure. I want to mention my friend Paul Stamets. I love Paul Stamets. He's a very good friend. He's, in my opinion, the leading mycologist in the world, the leading mushroom researcher. His website, fungi.com, F-U-N-G-I.com, is something you should check out and order some of his immune system products. You can also find some of his products in health food stores. There's a whole lot of online medicinal mushroom companies that are out there. I would recommend, instead of just getting reishi mushroom alone, which is cool, that's a good way to start if you want to, but you want to get mushroom combinations in general for long-term usage, because when you bring these together, when you have reishi together with shaga, with maitake, with shiitake, with the coriolis mushroom, say those five, then you get much stronger immunomodulating power. And the reason why I keep harping on this immune system thing, by the way, is because my research has shown me, and I think anybody who's objective in the field of health science will arrive also at the same opinion. What I've found is it's all about the immune system. If you want to live a long time, if you want to have vigorous health, if you want to be here, you know, to enjoy all your years, you got to have an immune system that's really sharp and functioning, so you're not getting beaten down with colds and flus and fevers. And especially, this is super important if you're an entrepreneur and if you're a CEO of your own company, because you got to be the person who has the most energy. And in order to do that, you got to stave off ever being sick or ever calling in sick. You got to be showing up early and staying late. How are you going to do that? Well, the medicinal mushrooms help a lot in that regard.
Do you ever get sick? Do you ever get colds?
No, impossible.
Okay, well, let me explore this a little. Impossible. What do you mean?
Meaning that it's
like
impossible.
Your system is physically it's not going to get sick.
Right, it's impervious. And people go, what in the world are you talking about? And actually, I could go into a 10-hour seminar on how to create an impervious immune system. Where we are actually at technologically in that area is way beyond the scope of what I can get into in this conversation. But I will put it out there, and people should be aware of it, because where we are actually at technologically in our understanding of the human immune system, where our immune system can be, what is the key, like, switches or big, you know, master flip switches that turn our immunity on or off. Where we are in that conversation is profound. I mean, I'm inspired to talk about that kind of stuff. But where do we start? Well, we start with step-by-step taking in herbal substances that we know affect our immunity substantially. And I've mentioned, you know, combining certain things together. I mentioned just the combination of the medicinal mushroom with a vitamin C complex. That's a really good way to go. Why is that? Well, because you can triple the efficacy of the vitamin C right there on the spot. Now, if you add the blue-green algae, as I mentioned, you could triple that again and get a 9-fold increase on your immunity. Well, I've got those tricks so deep into me that every drink I have every day has about 10 of those tricks in it, And I've been doing it for so long that I've kind of gotten to a place where, you know, I know where my immunity is, and I know, you know, I can feel the difference of where I was to where I'm at now. I don't know how better to describe it than that. And step by step, you can actually get your immune system into a place where you are unaffected by colds, fevers, flus, coughs, any of this kind of stuff.
Interesting. You know what's great about this interview? It's more like it's not quite like my other interviews where I would have more structure. It's more like what's really curious and interesting to Joe at the moment, and I just ask you questions about it. This seems to contradict something I recently heard, hearing a raw food expert, you know, talk about how sensitive the body becomes when you're on totally raw. And, you know, living in certain cities like New York City, you can't really do it because of the pollution and certain medicines that you may take. You know, your body can't even respond to them because your system is so clean. And that you can get sick easily if you're exposed to outside things. That may be a little different than what you're saying, but is when you say your body's impervious, can you put yourself in very polluted situations or going to a bar where everyone's smoking? Does your body respond differently than someone that's on a standard diet?
Yes. I mean, I am doing events. Like, I did an event in Toronto the other day. We drove 5 hours to the event, doing a bunch of errands on the way. Did the event in Toronto, which was about 6 hours, and then went out and partied for 4 hours. I do that every night. You know,
do you drink alcohol? Do you drink alcohol at all?
No, don't drink alcohol at all.
Okay.
So chocolate, again, is drug of choice, right, which, you know, most people go, well, you know, that's not going to do it for me. But if you purify yourself to a point where you don't need very strong stimulants to really feel, you know, the good feelings, chocolate is a really good tool to have in your arsenal.
Well, you know, hey, we're getting pretty romantic here with the coconut oil and the chocolates now. So are you saying that certain raw food people are, or their systems are very clean and very pure, but they're very sensitive to things where they can't expose themselves to stuff because they'll either get sick or whatever, are they doing something wrong?
I think so. Personally, yes, I think that's what's going on. I think what's happening there is they've narrowed their diet down to like wheatgrass shots, apples, you know, maybe, you know, one half an avocado a day, and, you know, sprout salads, which is cool, and it's a great cleansing thing, and definitely we can all benefit from doing those kinds of diets every now and then. But if we start living that way, we're not really fortifying ourselves with complete nutrition. And that's kind of where the superfoods come in, and that's also where the super herbs come in, as super herbs being the reishi mushroom and the maitake mushroom. And I also want to say this bit, which is a scientific discovery that was made by Dr. Paul Kuchkoff back in the 30s and has since been validated by numerous raw food people and scientists since. And that is, when we eat cooked food, what had been believed before is that when we ate any food, we would have a white blood cell reaction to the food. Doctors in the 1850s would look in people's blood and they'd say, my God, there's a reaction because this person ate food. There's a white blood cell reaction. That was thought to be the natural reaction to eating any food up until Kuchkoff came along in the 1930s, and he showed that was only true of cooked food. If you cook the food, then you'll have a white blood cell reaction. If you eat the food raw, you have no white blood cell reaction. Well, if you take that out to where we are now, it's pretty clear that pretty much every meal we've ever had has been cooked or processed in some way. So we had a white blood cell reaction, which is like the boy who cried wolf, right? Or we're constantly crying wolf on our immune system every time we eat something from our earliest days. So we have an overactive or hyper immunity kind of a system. When we go into raw foods, that shuts off because our body goes, whoa, we don't need to react to the food anymore. Okay, cool. And what can happen is a negative impact is that our immune system can be lulled to sleep because it hasn't been constantly, you know, the boy hasn't cried wolf every afternoon. So we can actually experience decreased immunity. And that's one of the reasons, again, why I recommend bringing in the medicinal mushrooms, bringing in the vitamin C botanicals like camu and amla berry and acerola cherry and that kind of stuff, in order to not allow our immune system to get too low so it can be susceptible.
Fascinating, absolutely fascinating. Well, this may sound like a stupid question, but for instance, I got one of the superfoods you mentioned is aloe vera. I've got in the front of my house, I've got planters of aloe vera because it's being grown in soil, and I'm using tap water to, you know, water them and various things like that. I mean, is that something where I could go cut a piece off and eat it, or is that like a stupid thing to do?
Well, it depends on if they're spraying your neighborhood or, you know, exactly what's going on with the soil, but it's probably fine to go break a piece off or cut it off, and then you want to fillet out the gel. That's an important point, because if you just throw the whole aloe vera in there with the skin on it, you might be calling me back and be in, like, you know, liquid plumber mode times about 10. I mean, it can be really intense. So you can eat the skin. It's not really poisonous, but it's an extreme laxative. So we want to take that gel out. And if you blend that gel, let's say the aloe vera leaf, let's say it's a foot long, and you got all that gel out of there, and you threw it into a Vitamix blender, which is a liter and a half, and you blended it into one of these smoothies I'm talking about, you wouldn't even taste it. You wouldn't even know it's in there. It completely blends right into it, which is great. So we get all that benefit of aloe vera, but we don't have to taste it.
But I guess you can overdose on these superfoods because they're so powerful, correct?
In the beginning, that's possible. It really depends on the person. I mean, most people who are like bodybuilder type people who just work out intensely and have a serious exercise program really can't OD on superfoods. But if you're a person who's, you know, very mellow, chilled out, not very active, you got to be careful because these superfoods are seriously high energy substances. And, you know, they've got to be, you got to go out and burn this stuff off because this is, you know, really intense quality of nutrients. And if you add on top of that quantity, it can overwhelm the system.
Well, okay, now you were talking in your kitchen. You actually have seaweed in various containers and stuff like that. So there's raw foods that are dry. I don't know if dry is the right word, but naturally dried. What's the shelf life on those things? I mean, if you throw raw seaweed into a container, I mean, how long will it last?
Years. It will last years. And see, that tells us something about seaweed in general. Seaweed is very rich, by the way, in trace minerals, which we know has a very important effect on our immune system and our metabolism and our longevity. But seaweeds are also very rich in these polysaccharides, which are antiviral, antifungal, antimicrobial, and that's why they can sit there for years in a container and not degrade. This is fascinating. And they can just be naturally dried on the beach. I mean, a lot of these seaweeds are just literally picked from a beach. They're dried on racks near the beach, and then they're thrown into packages and shipped out to people. What a great tool to have when you're traveling.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And this is giving me so much valuable information, so this is fantastic. What about coffee and teas?
Okay, so there's a flip temperature to tea that was found out in water. It's about 189 to 191 degrees Fahrenheit. I simplify that down to say 175, which is about 3/4 to boiling. What does that mean? It means that if we heat up water, and let's say we boil it. Let's say we boil the water, and then we cool it back down, we drink it. Our body will react to that water as if it's a foreign object, and our body goes, what the heck is this? And we'll have a white blood cell reaction, just like with the cooked food that I mentioned earlier. If we heated that water to, say, 150 degrees Fahrenheit, or let's say halfway to boiling, and then cooled it back down, and we drank that, there's no reaction. So there is a critical flip temperature somewhere above 3/4 to boiling where the water becomes, quote-unquote, cooked. So I never heat anything above that temperature. If I do, I notice it because I'm very sensitive to it. I can feel it, like, uh-oh, it went too far. So I make teas when I'm up here in the north because it's appropriate because I've got so many herbs from the forest that I picked the summer before that, you know, that's kind of what I live on is these herbal drinks. And I'd never boil it, and it's all done on a wood-burning stove, which I have here, with my Salad Master container. It's an absolutely awesome system, and I can hardly even tell you the great levels of elation and joy that I feel drinking herbs from my own backyard with spring water from our own backyard on a wood-burning stove in the stainless steel cookware. It's outrageous. It really is amazing.
You know what? You're sounding way too happy about that. I don't like it, actually. It's bumming me out here.
It's a little bit. See, people who are like in my world, you know, we're this is like hippies on steroids, right? This is like way out there. So, you know, like I get off on this kind of stuff, and people are like, dude, you know what? It's just a tea. I mean, calm down.
Well, no, look, I mean, you've got the curly hair and you've got sort of the look of someone doing some very natural stuff, but from my interactions with you, you're a pretty normal sort of guy. You're not completely way out there. I mean, obviously some people would say the guy's a complete freak. Are you kidding me? Look how he eats sort of thing. However, you know, I see the absolute benefits and the rationale behind it. Now, in the vegan world, in the raw food world, vegetarians, there are so many people that just look so unhealthy, and I think a lot of them are. And I've actually worked out with, you know, vegan friends of mine, and they're really weak. You know, when they're in the gym, they just don't have a lot of strength. And so, a couple of questions. First, why do so many people in that world just seem very strange? I mean, I don't know any other nice way to say it. They're just like
That's such a good question. I've been tossing that one over for years. People ask me that question all the time, and I think there's a number of factors. I think one is raw foods and veganism and vegetarianism and all this is fringe information, and therefore it attracts people who are on the fringe. It attracts people who didn't get, you know, a good card in the deck when they were born. Their genetics weren't quite there, and they weren't able to get away with all this other stuff, so they tended towards, you know, the Birkenstocks and the hippie lifestyle and the more gentle kind of lifestyle and moved away from sports, for example. So that's another factor. I think also this stuff is like it activates different aspects of your imagination and your creativity. So it kind of, if you're an artist, for example, it makes you like a full-on artist in your lifestyle and the way that you present yourself, and therefore, to the average observer, somebody goes like, whoa, that's like, that dude thinks he's Picasso, check out his hair. You know, it's, people look at you and they kind of go, you know, they kind of think you're like, you know, in the hippie world, or you're just totally freaked out, like Warhol, right? So they look at you like it's a Warhol or something, because this is how raw foodists look to the world. They look like this. I see that side of it. I also see, you know, that's, you know, there's some judgment in all that, because I do know some raw foodists who look like they're, you know, absolutely crazy, but are true geniuses in what they do and lead the field in, for example, I'm thinking of my friend Doug Evans, who has a totally crazy hairstyle. He grew up as a street kid in New York City. This guy is a titanic force of good for the planet. This year he's gearing up with his Organic Avenue company to serve 2 million juices to New York City residents, and he deals mostly with Fortune 500 CEOs, celebrities, stars, and he feeds them the best foods ever. And this guy, if you look at him, you go, he's an absolute flipped out hippie, but he's really a wolf in hemp clothing.
Wow, wow. Yeah, you know, you make a great point. It does open up your mind in lots of different ways. So that's totally understandable. And look, I mean, I've had various stages in my life where people look at me and the guy's a complete freak. I mean, especially in high school, you know, I was in high school in the 80s and, you know, I had a pierced nose that I did myself with a safety pin. People thought I was frickin' strange. That only lasted a couple weeks. But, you know, I had the pierced ear and, the bleached mohawk hair that I used to, you probably wouldn't have liked this because it involved the use of eggs, but I had such a huge, you know, spiked hair that I would use Knox gelatin or egg whites in order to keep it up. And I was a pretty strange looking sort of dude. So, you know, I'm all about people being, you know, nonconformist or whatever. It's just that I think one of the things where it's hard for people to accept a lot of how palatable this can be, if we could use that word for this context, is that they see a lot of people that are involved in it and they're like, oh, these people are absolutely strange and stuff. So that's why I wanted to ask you the question.
You know, I just got an email this morning from a woman who's a supermodel in Dubai, and she's an absolute, like, knockout, unbelievable, the most gorgeous looking woman you've ever seen. And she's a raw foodist. So sometimes what we hear, in the internet media of, you know, people on Facebook and stuff, is a little bit of the crazy side of the raw food scene. But there is another side of professionals, people who are in the acting profession who need to be sharp and on it. A good friend of mine is Woody Harrelson. I've been working with him on his nutrition for over 10 years. And he, you know, he's, if you look at him closely, he's doing better than ever. Why? Because he's fueled by raw food nutrition and superfoods. And he's, and not only that, you know, we've coached him on what to grow on his property in Hawaii. He's growing chocolate trees now and all kinds of amazing things. So there is another side of it that we don't often see, of titanic entrepreneurs, millionaire, billionaire professionals. I've been sending food to Steve Jobs for 15 years, 16 years. You know, that people who are into it, that don't, you know, aren't surrounded by the rhetoric.
Gotcha. Interesting. That's fascinating. You know what? I forgot. I kind of skipped over the coffee thing. You talked about teas, but I got to come back to that because I know there's going to be people that drink coffee every single day. Wanted to either have you speak to it and alternatives.
Okay. So what you can do with your coffee, this is a really simple idea. Take your blender and put some things in there that will help to mediate the coffee. Here's what you can do. You can take reishi mushroom capsules that you buy from the store. Another one is cordyceps mushroom, C-O-R-D-Y-C-E-P-S. These are available in every health food store in America. If you've never heard of them before, check them out. Dig into them. Amazing. You can get these as powders or encapsulated powders. Take four of each of the reishi and take four of the cordyceps of the capsules. They're usually 500 milligram capsules. Open them up into your blender. Okay, so just the powder's now next to the blades on the blender. Throw in a teaspoon of maca. Take maybe a dollop of honey, if that's what you like, as a sweetener. You can also take a little bit of maybe 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 cacao beans. Throw that in there. And then when you make your drink, your coffee, for example, when it's hot, you pour it into your blender, you blend it immediately, pour it through a strainer, and you've got a superfood mocha in your hands. Now, the cordyceps and the reishi are cleverly chosen for a reason, and that is they exactly neutralize the weak acids that are in coffee that tend to irritate people's systems, especially over years of coffee abuse. And they make the coffee come into your body in a little bit more gentle and friendly way. Instead of being hit over the head with a baseball bat, you're hit more like with a pillow. So it kind of comes in not as so shocking, but actually it's a little bit mediated. If you want to add a little bit of a milk to it, for example, to kind of cream it over a little bit, you can use almond milk or hemp seed milk or even rice milk in order to kind of give it that little bit of a buffer. That fat that's in these milks, you know, we used to use dairy milk, of course, is helping to mediate that intense hit over the head with a baseball bat experience of coffee. Now, when you do this, it'll profoundly change your coffee experience. You'll start to want to drink the coffee because it actually tastes good. Because most people are drinking it, they don't really want to, but they know they have to get the job done or to have a bowel movement, just to be realistic and honest. Anyway, you know, over the years, I do this for people when I go to their homes. I'll make these drinks for them. And over the years, I've found that whenever I come to somebody's house who's a coffee drinker and I've been making drinks for them, they don't even, like, say hello when I show up. The first thing out of their mouth is, can you make one of those drinks for us? Instead of, you know, hello or great seeing you or give me a hug or something. That's the first thing that they say. I haven't seen these people for, like, say, a year. That's how powerful these drinks can be.
That's great. That's great. So when it comes to you mentioned almond milk and rice milk and various things, you're suggesting people make that themselves?
And all other options. The reason why I chose those words is because you can either make them yourself or you can buy them in the store. They now have them in the carton containers. They're obviously not raw, those carton containers, but it's a better option than what we had before. And you'll notice that I deliberately left out soy milk, which is estrogenic, and in my opinion, actually, it's toxic. I wouldn't even consume any form of soy at all. It's not only not necessary, but I believe it's actually toxic. It's estrogenic. It disturbs the testosterone receptor site in both men and women, and it can have a very profound long-term problem.
Wow, fascinating. What about different nuts like peanuts? Are there any bad nuts that people should never eat?
There are wild Amazonian jungle peanuts out there that are aflatoxin-free. And if you're familiar with that word aflatoxin, that's actually what people are allergic to when they're allergic to peanuts. Peanuts are very rich in vitamin B3. And so, therefore, they can create a very strong heating reaction in your body, which can be uncomfortable for some people, but it is not an allergic reaction in a lot of cases, just to put that out there. There are certainly nuts that are available in bulk bins in stores. You know, when you go to a health food store and there's a big bin of like almonds and you pull the tray at the bottom and they all come flying out into a container, say a bag or a plastic bag or something, you got to be a little bit careful with just eating those straight out of bulk bins because they can be a little bit contaminated with mold and dirt on the outside. So I always wash nuts and seeds before I eat them if I buy them out of a bulk bin. Are there nuts that people should definitely not eat? I mean, sure, there are wild nuts that I've had in the jungles of Ecuador, for example, that were very severe laxatives and very toxic that tasted good, but those are not something you're going to find in a health food store.
Gotcha. Okay, so, I mean, people, in terms of eating, like, organic peanut butter and stuff, probably not a good idea, okay idea. I mean, how would you rate that?
You're better off with raw almond butter or raw hemp seed butter and better off to move away from processed peanut butters. Sunfood.com actually does have a raw organic peanut butter that's the only company in the world that has it. I helped develop that for that company, and that is a heck of a product. very good for kids if they're not allergic to peanuts.
Okay, great. That's great. So, you know, you've touched on it a little bit with digestive issues and laxatives and stuff, and so much of this hinges on what happens in our stomachs, in our intestinal tract, in our colons. So talk about raw food as it relates to that. I mean, I've heard lots of stuff about how disease exists in the colon, and if you keep that clean, so many diseases will never exist. What can you speak to regarding that? I mean, you can talk about any damn thing you want, colonics or cleansing or whatever.
Okay, cool. Well, let's just get into cleansing technology then, because there is this idea out there, and I believe it's a valid one just from experience, that we are toxic, that we've accumulated debris of food we've eaten that never was completely digested that's now existing in our colon as hardened fecal matter. You know, I remember first hearing that when Elvis died, and he had all this, you know, undigested meat in his colon. I don't know if you remember that story.
Oh, yeah, that and John Wayne.
John Wayne was another one, right?
Is that true?
Yeah, these are true stories. And, you know, when you start seeing that John Wayne had lung cancer and kidney disease and liver cancer. I mean, his whole insides were rotted, but the real cause was just this whole problem in the colon, right, where the rot is occurring. So we want to make sure we keep our bowels open and moving. What should that look like? It should be actually 2 or 3 bowel movements a day. Now, if it's less than that, then we've got to start looking at actually eating lighter or having more fiber in our diet, which means eating more vegetables and flax seeds and chia seeds and fruits and, of course, cacao, all great sources of cellulose fiber and soluble fiber, which helps to that digestive cascade to help move things through. I'm a big fan of colonics and enemas for helping to just pull that bathtub plug out and letting some of that dirty water out, because if we're all plugged up, even if we eat the good stuff, it may not be absorbing or maybe fermenting. It could be causing, you know, even worse problems to develop if it's fermenting on top of toxic sludge. So, you know, going into having your first colonics is quite an experience, and it's an important experience to have, because you start to see how much stuff that you're holding on to, because you can't believe how much stuff comes out of you in an hour at a colonic session. It's unbelievable how much stuff is coming out. And that will go on. You say you have 5 of those in a period of 2 weeks, which is a good idea. Always go to somebody who's very reputable, check references, you know, definitely want to do your research on a colon hydrotherapist. But when you find somebody good and you go there and you say do 5 in a period of 2 weeks, it's hard to believe how much stuff comes out. I have seen, by the way, many different people lose 100 pounds, 125 pounds, 150 pounds, 200 pounds, 250 pounds on the raw food-based diet that we're talking about here. And I know for a fact you don't sweat that weight off. You poop it out. That's how it comes off of you. It actually is pooped out of your colon. That's important to realize, because, you know, in your own weight loss journey, you may realize, wait a second, I can get a lot of this stuff out the easy way. Go get some colonics done, which is a good idea, because a lot can come out real fast. Going beyond that, there are herbal cleanses on the market. There are designer detox products like zeolite, this mica adja clarity product that's out there right now. There is fulvic acid, shilajit from the Ayurvedic tradition. These things are also very good assistants in detoxifying us of some of the more dangerous chemicals that are in our environment, including petroleum byproducts, pesticides, formaldehyde, and I do have to say it, actually depleted uranium, which is present in my friend Dr. Gabriel Cousins. Tested 60 people. He found 59 people actually had some level of depleted uranium in their body, which is totally shocking information. But it's not a surprise, because we've detonated 250 nuclear weapons in the atmosphere of the Earth since 1945. So, you know, this is also a problem. And then, you know, there's a whole other area beyond these designer detox products, which is this area which we call chelation by replacement. Very important idea for detoxification, which is this. Let's just say in the example of radiation poisoning. If somebody gets contaminated with radiation, what happens? Well, they get a thyroid problem. That's the first symptom of radiation poisoning. And what it means is that radioactive iodine has taken the place of healthy iodine, or actually it's a toxic imposter. And so what we are always trying to do is we're trying to bring in higher quality nutrients of the same sort and variety. So higher quality iodine from, say, kelp seaweed or nori seaweed will chelate by replacement and push out the iodine, the bad iodine, the radioactive iodine, and replace it with healthy iodine. And that's the lesson that we learned in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, that the seaweed eaters actually survived the radiation sickness because they didn't develop thyroid disease. That's a super fascinating area of research. I've been just doing a lot of writing in the last couple of days on this area because I'm rewriting a second edition of my Longevity Now program, and there was a lot of requests for more information on detoxification. So again, you know, this is why it's very fresh in my mind. Now, chelation by replacement, just to bring that to its appropriate destination, what it really looks like is just exchanging higher quality nutrients for lower quality, or in the computer sense of the term, we're just upgrading our operating system. As we upgrade that operating system, let's say we come off of, I don't know, I used to eat the fat off ribs, you know, that's what I ate, you know, that type of saturated fat, which is pretty darn toxic. Now I'm doing coconut oil. So the coconut oil is a saturated fat, but it displaces out that toxic version of the saturated fat. We can go across the entire board with all the minerals, all the amino acids, so all the protein. We can go through all the hormones and hormone precursors that we can take in our diet. And again, we're just upgrading with each added new superfood, super herb, raw and living food. We're upgrading the quality of the substances in our body, and step by step, the effect is felt and seen.
On the subject, since there's very rare that I actually do interviews where people are actually talking about bowel movements and whatnot, I remember years ago, one of my first interviews with our goofball friend, Mark Victor Hansen, Chicken Soup for the Soul, he says on the interview that you should have a foot-long, fluffy floater. You know, this is how you should have a bowel movement. And out of left field, I mean, we weren't even really talking about health, and he said this, and of course, Mark is known to have these random, weird, bizarre things. And, you know, I was just like, it was hysterical because I've never had anyone talk about a bowel movement on the Genius Network interview, especially when we're talking about personal development. But anyway, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, how often should somebody have a bowel movement? What is healthy? What is the consistency? That sort of stuff. And I know how much of an issue that is, because if you do a search online on anything related to digestion, there's so many questions and comments about that. So from a raw foodist perspective, what is the best way for your system to actually not only consume food but digest it? What is healthy? How does someone know?
Okay, well, let's talk about when to have a bowel movement. Of course, the first bowel movement of the day should be after we get up in the morning. We drink a lot of water, and it should be the best pure water we can find. I prefer living spring water that I collect from local springs around my house.
Let me stop you for a minute. Do you ever drink bottled water?
I will drink bottled water in glass only.
Okay.
I don't drink bottled water in plastic.
Got it. Okay. Well, why is that? And then we'll come back to the drinking water part.
Well, we've all had the experience of distilled water in those plastic jugs, like those milk jugs, and then it tastes like plastic afterwards.
Uh-huh.
Well, the research I've seen and I've been involved in plastics and their xenoestrogen effects and how they can screw up our testosterone receptor site and our DHEA receptor sites and progesterone receptor sites, it's pretty conclusive that the water actually, the plastic can leach into the water and cause a host of problems. Leading eventually to having estrogen dominance, which means we tend to have growth form in our body, which is really another word for cancer. So I don't do the plastic bottled thing. I got off of that years ago just from what I've learned about plastic. And, of course, I've known not only a lot about what plastics do in water, but the way that the bottled water industry works is that they blow the plastic and then they immediately put the water in it. If you want to avoid leaching of plastic, they need to blow the plastic, let it sit on a shelf for a year, then fill it with water. That is not done in the plastics industry, or the bottled water industry. So, you know, because I know that and I know the ins and outs of it, I avoid water that's in plastic and I go for water that's in glass. Now, let's say, you know, wherever you are, you're at a hotel, you're at home. What you want to do is when you get up in the morning, you drink a liter, at least a liter of fresh water, or the best water you can get, before you have anything else, before coffee, before tea, before scrambled eggs, before whatever it is, before the smoothie, and you allow your system to flush out. You allow that bowel movement to occur in the morning, and it should be like a foot long, well-formed, And it doesn't have to float, but if it does, that's a good sign, but it doesn't have to. That's not a requirement. And that's showing that you're actually digesting your food. And if you look at what's coming out, which is probably a good idea, and you see that everything's actually digested, great. But if you see that green leaves are coming out, or food that you ate last night, like, you know, the tomatoes are coming out undigested, then this is indicating that we have low digestive acids, we have low digestive enzymes, and we have low digestive flora, or friendly bacteria. And this can all be, you know, helped by changes in diet, by changes in stress levels. It can also be assisted by taking in special supplements like betaine hydrochloride, which is a wonderful hydrochloric acid supplement that helps with digestion, and enzyme supplements, which are also wonderful supplements that not only help with digestion but also help with metabolism. Now, let's say you go into your day, you start working through your day, and you have your food, and you keep going. Sometime before the end of the day, you should have at least another bowel movement. In the middle of the day, at the end of the day, is fine, but it should be a similar type of bowel movement, usually not as big. It could be floaty or not, doesn't matter, but I generally think that that's a little bit overemphasized, that it needs to float. I think that gives people the wrong idea. And if you have two bowel movements a day, you're doing real good. If you have three, you're doing even better. You may notice that if you take in certain substances, certain teas or vegetable juice, this can actually trigger a bowel movement to occur. Chocolate also can, by the way. Aloe vera is another one. These can all trigger bowel movements because of their unique array of nutrients. In the case of chocolate, it's magnesium, which helps to stimulate the digestive cascade. In the case of aloe vera, it's the tremendous amount of polysaccharides, which are, you know, so detoxifying and cleansing, they just literally instantly flush your system.
Wow. What about caffeine?
Okay, so what about caffeine? Is there caffeine in chocolate? And the answer is there's very little caffeine in chocolate. Actually, it's almost none. Chocolate is a very poor source of caffeine. That's been known in the industry for, you know, 150 years. Now, when you look at chocolate bars, you see it's got, wait a second, it's got a lot of caffeine in it. Well, I that was confusing to me when I first got in the chocolate business, but then I found out that in the third world, where chocolate is all processed now, it's not processed in Belgium or in the United States, it's all processed in Africa and South America, they're adding in kola nut and guarana, which are caffeine-rich botanical herbs, into the chocolate liqueur, and they do that without even, it's not even on the label. They don't even tell you that they've added those things on the label, and they're spiking the caffeine content. And they're doing it, you know, for obvious reasons, and this is one of these, like, nefarious things that goes on in that industry.
Interesting. Wow. Well, there's so many strange things that go on behind the scenes. If people actually, you know, that's why I love the movie Food, Inc. that I recommend everyone watch that movie, is when you really see what happens between getting where the food originates and how it ends up on your plate or wherever it ends up. It's quite fascinating. Plastic bottles, plastic containers, drinking out of plastic glasses. I failed to ask you about that in your kitchen. I mean, do you store anything in, you know, plastic containers, or do you keep everything glass?
I have everything in glass.
Is it just bad in general to keep anything in plastic?
In my opinion, yes. I think the plastic industry was very poorly controlled for a very long period of time. We're starting to get some ethics in that industry, which is good. We're getting changes, positive changes, which is excellent. And, you know, in general for me, I'll travel around with my favorite glass bottle. And I, you know, I'll pack in my luggage, and, you know, this is like good glass. It won't crack. I have an awesome liter container that I use to have a cork on it. And then when I get into a certain city, I'll ask the locals, where's the local spring? Now, anybody can do this. Where you can go to the local spring, they're always around. Like when I was in Calgary, we went up to the mountains, it was an hour drive, and there's a spring coming out of the ground, and there's an infinite amount of fresh, living water that you drink that, and you feel like $1 million. Actually, you feel like $1 billion, because $1 million isn't worth that much anymore. So you drink that, and it's amazing, right? And it's all free, and it's natural, and it's coming from the earth itself, and it's been purified by the earth itself. And that's a big hobby for me, is hunting down wild springs, not only in my local area, but wherever I travel.
Okay, now if you're in a hotel somewhere and you don't have access to, you know, pure water in a glass container, and you're, I mean, what do you do? Do you filter it through anything?
if I have, there's always access, I found. I mean, there's always, like, I was staying in a hotel in Amsterdam, and in the middle of the night, I kind of wandered out to their bar, and I was like, oh, wait, they got glass water right there, and it's refrigerated. It was, like, nice and cold spring water and glass. It's always there if you really look. But let's say you can't find it, it's not around. Here's what I do. I go thirsty. I don't drink. It's not, if it's not quality enough, I won't drink it.
Interesting, interesting. Wow, that's good to know. Okay, what about just a couple more things I'm going to ask you, and then we'll wrap up. Supplements, enzymes that you would consume, those sort of things, good, bad, what do you know?
Supplements are all over the board, as we know. I mean, they can be great, high-quality substances. They can be low, cheap stuff. Generally, I don't take vitamin and mineral supplements of any kind, and I definitely recommend against taking calcium supplements, which are not only have no effect. This is one of those things, Joe, that blows people's minds right out of the water. I'm going to say something here that everybody should be aware of, and when you hear it, you're not even going to believe it, but if you do the research, you'll find out it's true. Calcium supplements have never been shown to increase bone density and have never been shown to affect osteoporosis in any way except make it worse.
Wow.
Now, I've written a whole book on that subject right there, which is the Longevity Now program, which has to do with this whole idea of aging has a lot to do with calcification or the excess production of bad calcium in our system or our inability to deal with the calcium that we're taking in. Calcium has nothing to do with bone density, and that right there is a great conversation, which I'd love to have, but it's a long one because it gets into our theory about physics. It gets into our theory about metabolism. It gets into the real power of enzymes, and that's a whole issue. But I really want to just stress very strongly, if you want to build your bones, do not take calcium supplements. Instead, take foods that are very rich in magnesium, like cacao or chocolate and all chocolate products, and foods that are very rich in silicon. And, of course, silicon-rich herbs are horsetail extract, nettle extract, oat straw. These are available in health food stores and are usually under bone formula for bone density. So, again, the key minerals are magnesium and silica, and there's trace minerals involved, but it's not calcium for building bone density. And that should get your mind going, you know, a little bit curious, but we'll have to save that for another conversation.
If the listeners love this and they found tremendous value, I'll be happy to do a follow-up interview if you would also and continue, because this is just amazing. My initial thing was half the amount of time we would spend talking about this, but I decided right in the middle here that let's just keep on going and we'll just do a nice, long, very informative conversation. Enzymes. What are your thoughts on enzymes?
I think enzymes are, in general, very good to take. Most of what's in the stores are weak. You always want to go for the strongest formulations out there. I really recommend an enzyme product that I helped develop. I don't benefit financially from it anymore, but it's called Beauty Enzymes, and I can vouch it's the most powerful metabolic and digestive enzyme out on the market because I'm intimately involved in how it was produced. Now it's all automated, and I'm not involved anymore, but it's an amazing product available at the Sun Food website. Again, Beauty Enzymes is that product, and its efficacy is self-evident. Once you start taking it, you start seeing what it does for you, and it gives you a feeling of lightness, of cleanliness. It's also a very good laxative if you take it in large dosage in the morning, like if you take four in an empty stomach in the morning, really good to kind of clear your system out. And what do enzymes do? Enzymes clear out the excess debris in our system. If there's protein that's undigested, it helps to more completely digest it, not only in our digestive tract, but enzymes get absorbed right into our bloodstream and actually can help clean up our blood. We can also say the same with fats and oils that we've taken in that we haven't completely digested. If you take enzymes like Beauty Enzymes that have lipase in them, which is the fat-splitting enzyme, again, that helps us break down the fats and the oils. We may notice clarity of thinking. We may notice better digestion. We might notice a higher feeling of lightness of being. These are parts of taking enzymes. Also, enzymes are anti-inflammatory. And so if we have chronic inflammatory conditions, enzymes are wonderful to take. The great enzyme that's sold throughout Europe for the last 60 years, and it's even wider selling product than aspirin is in Europe, is Wolfe enzyme, which is a wonderful anti-inflammatory and anti-aging enzyme.
Wow. Oh, well, what about sweets? A lot of people have a sweet tooth out there. What are some recommendations on that?
Well, we got such great choices now with these raw superfood sweet chocolates. We've got, I mean, I really recommend Sacred Chocolate. That's a heck of a company. I'm working with Sacred Chocolate right now on uploading all the data ever compiled in the field of chocolate and health is going to be on that website. But if they also have some, I think, 22 different raw cold processed chocolate bars that are like, you know, a chocolate sweetheart's dream. You know, if you have a sweet tooth for chocolate and you like the sweet stuff, they're right there is the healthiest chocolate in the world that tastes something that will just blow your mind. I mean, Steve Adler, who runs that company, he cracked the code on the melt-in-your-mouth chocolate thing. I mean, I think he's beyond the Belgian chocolatiers, the Swiss chocolatiers. I think he's actually in a league all his own. So I want to recommend that sacredchocolate.com site for people who have a real sweet tooth. And, of course, you can still look in your own local health food store for these raw sweets that are out there, these raw treats and desserts and raw chocolates to meet that sweet tooth need.
What about raw sugar? Is it bad for you, or can you take it in certain, you know, doses?
Well, there's a product out there called raw sugar, which is definitely bad for you. It's not raw. It's a good name. I guess they're benefiting because, you know, people are going, wait, this is raw, but it's not. It's granulated, refined white sugar, and white sugar has a very toxic effect on our liver. It causes us to develop a fatty liver. It depletes us of minerals, and it causes hypoglycemia, which eventually cascades into diabetes type 2 syndromes. So just a little bit on that because we haven't really got into sugar that much. But are there raw forms of sweeteners that are great? I like the clear agave is a wonderful sweetener. If you're living in the desert like you're living there, Joe, you need something that's from the desert, and that's a great one. Desert honeys from that environment are exceptionally awesome. I travel a lot with the desert honeys that I get from the Arizona desert. And then, you know, of course, beyond honey and agave, there are also yacone root syrup sweeteners, lo han guo, which is a Chinese medicine sweetener. There's stevia sweeteners, and these are things that are a little bit in the category of medicinal sweeteners. Then there's xylitol, which isn't a raw food product, but is one heck of a medicinal sweetener and is a really good switch for somebody who's switching off the refined stuff to something else. Just switch to white powdered xylitol, which actually has medicinal effects. Originally it was isolated in birch bark. Now I have had birch syrup, like maple syrup. I think maple syrup's a reasonable sweetener. It's not raw. But birch syrup is one of those products that I'm literally talking to people on farms here in Ontario to try to get them to produce enough so I can go out there and sell that product, because I think that product is an amazing product, and it contains that medicinal xylitol naturally.
Well, you know, going back to chocolate, I mean, can you consume too much chocolate? Because I think there's a lot of people that will be like, I love chocolate. This is like the best thing I've heard.
Well, you got to tune into your own metabolism. For example, I have a high tolerance for chocolate. I can eat chocolate all day long, all night long, and it doesn't bother me one bit. There are other people who are very sensitive to it, and there's people who are allergic to it. So we all fit into that spectrum in all foods that we eat, right? Some foods are good for us, some are not. We just got to tune into, you know, how much is too much. Now, I did notice one year I went to Europe, and I did a whole bunch of touring over there, and I accidentally had brought like 100 vanilla beans with me. And we've all heard about, you know, chocolate and vanilla, right? They go together. Well, I basically was traveling with different chocolate products and vanilla. So whenever I was out of food or couldn't find a health food store or whatever, I would just snack on a little bit of my raw chocolate. And I noticed that if I ate some of that vanilla or I soaked my water in the vanilla, that it balanced it out. It seemed to be the cure for a chocolate hangover. So if you're suffering from a chocolate hangover, vanilla may be the answer, something definitely worth trying.
What about exercise? How do you actually physically stay fit other than what you consume food-wise?
I've got a few answers to that question. One of the ways is moving boxes, man. I mean, I've been an author, and you know, I've got like 7 books out there in the world, and I tell you, those things weigh a lot. And when you go and do shows, you got to truck those books in. Probably the primary exercise I get in my life, the biggest weights that I lift in my life are books. So that's one form of exercise. I like to, in my daily life, especially when I'm at home, I like to couple my exercise with foraging. You know, in the forest that's behind my house here, I've got wild mushrooms and different plants that I know about. Even in the winter, there's amazing plants out there that I go out and I forage. So I'm not just out there hiking. I'm also out there doing something. You know, as an entrepreneur and as a business owner, you know, I've been running now. I think I've got 5 businesses going right now. you've got to be able to knock down six coconuts with one stone. You've got to stack what you do so it's not just exercise, but you've got to be getting a bunch of stuff done at the same time. So when I'm out foraging, I'm not only foraging and getting my exercise, but I'm also looking for unique things to bring back to my garden. Sometimes I'll find a plant in the forest, and I'll know what the plant is, and I'll bring it back to my garden because I'd like to have one on the corner of my garden or something like that. So I'm always thinking that way, that I want to knock down six coconuts with one stone, and just, you know, one simple form of exercise in a gym isn't going to cut it for me. It's got to be more extreme than that.
Gotcha. Yeah, you know, because see, for me and my lifestyle, I lift weights, I do yoga, I do cardio, and I purposely, exercise aside from even just, you know, running and biking and hiking every once in a while. I specifically make time every day to exercise with, you know, strength training, stretching, and some form of cardio. I mean, heck, what are the main reasons why you have adopted this sort of lifestyle and why you live this way? I mean, what are some of the benefits as we wrap up? And then I'd like to, you know, get any final suggestions that you have for people that may want to transition and take this on. Why do you really do all of this?
At this point, the reasons are actually spiritual, to tell you honestly. Again, I'm not a spiritual, airy-fairy type of a person, but the connection that I feel to the natural world, eating the food that's coming from my garden right here, I mean, anybody can come into my garden or any animal. I've had bears in my garden, deer, elk, moose. I mean, anything can come in here. I live next to a wild forest. But I feel really connected to the wild forest and to all of life on Earth because I eat raw food. That is a profound part of my own experience of life, and it keeps me really relentlessly inspired. I'm very inspired by that part of it. Health is just it's like a given. I mean, we've seen how ill people can become, you know, and still be alive. All of us have gone through relatives or friends who had cancer, and just step by step by step, you know, their downward spiral, we've seen it. Well, we haven't seen the other side. How healthy can somebody become? So just getting to be healthy, I think, is pretty straightforward and simple. You know, get off the toxic stuff, eat a lot more raw foods and vegetables, add some superfoods and super herbs in your lifestyle as best you can, drink pure water, boom, you're there. If you have an exercise program, even better. But beyond that, I'm exploring, you know, the very, very extreme edges of what it is to be, you know, as the healthiest that a human being can be. And it's awesome. It's fantastic. And that's why, you know, I keep doing what I'm doing, because I keep finding out there's even, you know, another thing above. And, you know, it never ends, obviously. It just keeps going. It's just like in business. You always just find there's more and more vistas to conquer and further that you can go. So, you know, that's my feeling about what motivates me. And I'm having a heck of a good time doing what I'm doing. I love it.
Yeah, well, and you know, you not only have done a tremendous amount of research and studying, and you're your own R&D experiment, your own life. You've adopted this lifestyle, you know. But you're doing something which a lot of people don't do, is you've learned how to package it and get it out and share it with other people, which is why it's been a pleasure to pick your brain and ask you all of these questions in a totally random format, jumping all over the place. But just so much stuff here that you shared and that you discussed, and it really shows me just how expansive this whole field is. And you know, I'm happy that I'm in the position where I'm able to actually interview people and learn so much about what it is they do. And this has been one of the latest areas for me where I really want to jump into and learn and adopt as much as I can into my life. So having said that, I'm sure there's a lot of people that are listening that would like to do the same thing. So from your perspective, what are some resources? You've mentioned a lot on this interview, but just to transition, if someone really says, yeah, I want to take this on, where's the best place for them to start and get more information about you, maybe purchase any of your trainings or buy any of your books? Where should someone start? What should they do if they want to go down this path?
Well, I think you're right on with the recommendations about education. And my books, you know, I want to mention this because you more than anyone who's ever interviewed me can really understand what I'm about to say. When I was 16 years old, my mom, I think she won a ski trip, or we got some kind of comp ski trip from Caesars Tahoe in Lake Tahoe. So we flew to Reno from San Diego, which is where I grew up, and we went on the ski trip, and Caesars had sent a limousine down to pick us up in Reno. We were all, you know, I'm like 15, 16 years old. I'm totally stoked about this. And they had a TV screen in the back of this limo, and we watched a program, and this was an hour-long documentary on Mike Tyson. And this is before he was anything. He was a nobody at that time, and he was like 9-0. But it looked like this guy was going to become something. And if you remember back then, Joe, I'm sure you do, you know, that was back in the Larry Holmes days where, you know, it was jabbing and just the fights just became awful after the great, you know, run that Muhammad Ali had. So this thing about Mike Tyson looked like it was real good. You know, this could be something cool. But Mike Tyson said something in that interview that radically changed my life, and it made me into the person that I am today. And what happened was the interviewer asked Mike Tyson, said, you know, what makes you great? What makes you think that you're going to be the champion? And Mike Tyson looked him right at the eye and he said, I throw every punch with mean intentions. I throw every punch to knock the person out. Now, I had never heard a philosophy like that. I never heard anything like that before. I mean, it was like a shocking moment for me. I was like, whoa, this is something that's inspiring to me. He's not there, you know, in the Larry Holmes days of jabbing and running, jabbing and running, jabbing and running and winning on points. No, he's not interested in that. He's interested in a knockout immediately, first punch. Now, in my career, what I always strive to do, and hopefully it comes through in our talk together over the last few hours here, is that I try to make everything punchy so that every single sentence is carrying weight. So it's carrying the strength of a potential action on the part of the listener, and that it gives them enough tools to actually go, wait a second, I could do that. You know what I mean? So every single statement, does that make sense what I'm saying?
No, here? Totally.
So every single statement that I've ever put into any of my books is always punchy. I mean, I've rewritten my book, The Sun Food Diet, which I recommend that people read, The Sun Food Diet Success System, which to me is the idea of fusing together the success and prosperity consciousness world with the diet, you are what you eat world, and bring it together in a beautiful symbiosis. Anyway, I've rewritten that book at least 16 times over from beginning to end in order to make every sentence punchy. I just got the fourth edition of my Eating for Beauty book out. Same thing there. Every sentence, punchy, carrying weight, carrying leverage, giving people some information that can sway them from an old behavior into a new behavior. And that's the way I approach life. If you read my book, Amazing Grace, I think you have Amazing Grace.
Yes, I do.
You'll get a kick out of that book if you jump into that. That's written for people who are readers. I'm a big believer in reading, and I believe that readers are leaders. But that book, again, is another one where it's very, very punchy, very pertinent, very powerful information, and it's a distillation of the knowledge. Okay, so going beyond that, I do want to recommend my books, The Sun Food Diet Success System, Eating for Beauty, Amazing Grace, Superfoods, The Food and Medicine of the Future. I have a book out on chocolate. Naked chocolate is one worth looking at if you're a chocolate chocoholic or a chocolatier. The Longevity Now program is about calcium and this calcification business, and also about real bone density, how to build bone density. And then I've got an audio program, which is a 21-day program that's available at 21daystohealth.com, 21daystohealth.com. It's 2-1, the number's 2-1, daystohealth.com. Going into, like, what do people do right now who've been listening? Well, we've talked about some ideas, so I want to recap them. One of the ideas is let's tend towards what's natural. That's why I always recommend superfood powders or just superfoods in general before going into complex whey proteins that have all these synthetic isolates added back in, and they're not even organic. So that kind of stuff is kind of the old school. We're moving away from it. We're moving towards just straight superfood powders. We know exactly what we're getting. No weird stuff is making it in there. So I want to just put that in as a bias we can all have that helps us to select healthier choices. Another thing about these superfoods, of course, is that we start with whatever ones we see first. Let's say you walk into a health food store. There's hemp protein right there. Boom. Pick it up. Buy it. Check it out. Try it. Let's say we're buzzing around online. All of a sudden you see, boom, organic goji berries at some website. Hit it. Get a ton of them. Get 2 pounds of them and really play around with them. Chew these things up. Feed them to your kids. You know, really see what that's all about. Let's say you're really onto this whole chocolate thing. Start there. One of the things that I'm a very big believer in is that each one of us is endowed with very special skills and disciplines that are different from everybody else, and that we need to turn the juice on what our strengths are and what our strengths are as related to our health disciplines and get away from our weaknesses, not even focus on strengthening our weaknesses. What does that look like? For me, it looks like blending stuff because I'm really good at blending stuff. I'm terrible at juicing stuff, but I'll never clean the juicer. I'll skip it. I'll find reasons not to juice, right? That's if I said to everybody right now, like, okay, you have to eat raw food two meals out of the three per day, there's going to be people go, okay, I can do that. There's going to be people who also go, there's no way in heck I'm doing that, because it's against their normal pattern and habits and disciplines and skills. Does that make sense?
Totally.
Okay, so we want to focus on what our strengths are and how they relate to health. So let's say somebody is like super full on like exercise fanatic. That's a strength for them, and they're able to like guzzle down a blended drink before and after their workout. Boom, we put all the superfoods in right there. Let's say somebody goes, I can do everything in the morning perfect. Once it hits the afternoon, I fall apart. Boom, we throw all the health disciplines right there into the morning. So that's how we activate this information. We take what we've heard and we go, okay, that's one I can do, that's one I can do, but this other stuff I can't do that right now. And then this other stuff, maybe I can do it in 2 months, but not right now. And so we organize it in that way. We take immediate action in the way that we can. Let's say we walk in the health food store and you're thinking, I heard this David Wolfe guy talk about reishi mushroom. Boom, we go right to the counter and say, where's your reishi mushroom? They show you what it is, buy it, try it, check it out, see what it does for you, and you can do that. Let's say you're going out to dinner in a restaurant and you're going, okay, where do I go for business dinners? You know, my friend Doug Evans, who I mentioned, who's a titanic entrepreneur from New York, he takes people, all his Fortune 500 executives that he works with, he takes them all to raw food restaurants like Pure Food and Wine in New York City, where he wines them and dines them on natural foods, raw foods. And that's something you may want to do. You might want to find your local raw food restaurant, like if you live in New York, and take all your business dinners there, so you're kind of knocking down again six coconuts with one stone, if you remember that. Let's say you're a real adventure fanatic like I am and you love running around in the woods and that's your form of exercise. Start tuning in on springs and spring water. Bring a bottle with you and start finding out how you can get your water for free, pure, fresh, spring, ice-cold water coming out of the local forest or ecosystem near your house, and start having some real adventures and exploring, you know, some of these great gifts of the natural world. That might be a real plus for somebody who likes to, for example, jog through the woods, you know, in their morning hour jog. What else? Soup. We've talked also about some of these. I was briefly referencing some of these great herbal systems of the world: Chinese medicine, Ayurvedic medicine, Amazonian shamanism. You know, the history of Egyptian medicine and culture, the North American and Native American systems from up here, the Central American systems. If you are working with one of the systems, let's say it's a Chinese herbal practitioner, one of the things you want to start looking for is getting onto these herbs, really actually taking them. And I don't mean taking these little black little balls that these little practitioners give you, you don't know what the heck it is, but I mean really sitting down with your practitioner and saying, look, I really want to get into these herbs, but I don't want the processed stuff. I want you to tell me how to make the teas, show me how to blend the stuff down and get on with it. And you'd be amazed at the respect and response you get from your, say, Chinese medical practitioner when you start talking that language, and then they will show you, boom, how you can take advantage of their herbal knowledge, which suddenly can become your knowledge, and lo and behold, in a very short period of time, through internet education, you can become an expert in these areas.
Well, you know, that is the beauty of today, is that so much of this, like you mentioned at the very beginning, can be found totally online. So what are the websites of yours that they should check out that you've not mentioned already, or to reiterate, this is where to go, because certainly you've covered so much valuable stuff here. I really appreciate it, and I think this is simply just the start, and I think this opened up a whole new world of knowledge for people, and you've put it all together, and I mean, you're continually, it's never ending. I mean, I know you're out there working really hard to bring this knowledge and these resources to people and to make them healthier. And I mean, you know, you're doing it for a good reason. I mean, you really care about helping people, and that shows. So where should they go to track you down and get hooked up with your trainings?
Right on. Thank you. Well, davidwolfe.com, it's WOLFE, davidwolfe.com, has all my events scheduled there. So if you wanted to connect with me, I do a lot of dinners. I do a lot of trainings, weekend trainings, week-long trainings, retreats. It's all listed there. We're headed to Australia in February of 2010. So if you're listening down under, you can catch us by going to David Wolfe, W-O-L-F-E, AustralianTour.com. And all that information is on that website. I also have thebestdayever.com, all four of those words together, thebestdayever.com, which is an online health magazine that really brings this cutting-edge information to reality. It's a community-based website, and we have video, audio, text files, and community to help support you and people who will answer your questions real-time, live, on the site all day long. It's a tremendous resource. Then longevitynowprogram.com, which is where we launched the Longevity Now program from. We just sold out of the first edition, so it's going to be about 4 to 6 weeks until we have the second edition out, so you might want to wait on that. And then our nonprofit arm, and you know, as an entrepreneur, of course, I'm very interested in giving back to the community, and we do that through planting fruit trees all over the world, and that's at www.ftpf.org.
Awesome. FTPF, as in Fruit Tree Planting Foundation.org.
You got it. Exactly.
Awesome. There was so many valuable things that you've shared. Clearly, your knowledge base and wisdom in this area is enormous. I really appreciate you taking the time. I mean, you covered literally 16 years of learning and condensed it into the period we gave this, and I know this is just a starting point. So I would highly encourage everyone listening to start reading David's books, check this stuff out. But the real test is if you just start eating this way, you're just going to feel better. And that's what gets pretty much everyone hooked, and hooked in a good way. And there's a lot of sources in the world that are supporting very unhealthy styles of eating and living that simply kill people. And diseases and so many things. You know, my standpoint on this, David, both my parents died from cancer.
Oh.
And there's a lot of disease in the world that is completely unnecessary if people learn how to better take care of themselves. And I think if you have someone in your life that you think would really be helped and supported by listening to this, I would encourage you to take this very long conversation that I have with David, filled with great stuff, and share it with them. So from my standpoint, you have my permission to share this with anyone, because I think a lot of people need to hear this. And if you want to hear more from David Wolfe, please let me know, and I will do a follow-up interview with him. And at some point, David, I'd love to have you come to one of my conferences and share. And I just want to thank you. So any famous last words?
Well, I want to thank you for being such a gracious host, and I really enjoyed our time together. And I wanted to mention that, you know, really what I'm onto for all the folks that are listening from your audience, which involves a lot of entrepreneurs and the people who are really turning the screws of our society, is we're looking to activate genius. We are looking to activate genius. So I hope that some of the information that we've imparted here in this conversation is helping to activate your genius. And, you know, that's such a great thing, because this is, in fact, the Genius Network. And much love to everybody listening. I hope you all have the best year of your life and experience the best day ever, every single day.
Awesome. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And to all our listeners, please give me your feedback on this. I'd love to hear what you have to say and the follow-up with what you said about Genius Network. That's really my marketing term. It's about wisdom. It's about knowledge. And I want to connect people with genius-level stuff. And in this area, you're the man. And so everyone just got connected to your genius, so thank you.
Thank you so much, Joe. It was a really good conversation, and totally appreciate you taking the time to interview me, and I hope you have the best holiday ever.
Hello, this is Joe Polish. I want to thank you for taking the time to listen to this interview. I hope you found it very useful. Please give me your feedback on all of the interviews that you listen to. I'd love to hear your feedback so we can always deliver a great program for you. Our website is www.joepolish.com, and we also have a Joe Polish Recommends section, so you can take a lot of the ideas and concepts that you hear on my Genius Network interview series and apply them to your business and find vendors and resources. You can go to joepolish.com to find that information and click on the Joe Polish Recommends section. And also, if you would like to find out about more interviews and invest in more useful Genius Network series interviews, go to www.geniusnetwork.com. Thanks, and eat your competition alive.